It's Friday, the 20th day of May 2016. I'm your host, Alex Jones. We'll have open phones again today, and we have a jam-packed roster of key guests and more coming up. We have Larry Nichols popping in for 30 minutes in the middle of the next hour, the Clinton insider on the fact that Trump's now coming out exposing the rape. And, of course, we have the big news that in a whole bunch of national polls, but two brand new ones, Donald Trump is now way ahead of Hillary Clinton because he took the gloves off against her. That is giant news. We also have Peter Schiff joining us to break down different developments with the economy. And we also have Blair White joining us, who is one of these individuals that is transgendered but critical of the whole leftist angle and bent to the movement. So that is coming up today. You don't want to miss this broadcast. David Knight will host the fourth hour. You know, I could say strap yourselves in, get ready. This is going to be an important broadcast. I could say, oh my gosh, the world government's out in the open. Things are intensifying. There's just an orgy of over-the-top news. And I guess I did just say that, but I am flabbergasted by how crazy this world's gotten. And every once in a while, I don't prepare for a show, and the crew says, man, that was the best broadcast you've done in a long time. It seems like the more I prepare, by the time I get on air, my head is spinning. I mean, it really, 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 really is. But I'll tell you my main takeaway. The social engineers want us dysfunctional, want us mentally ill. They want us to be completely backstabbing and to be backstabbed ourselves. They don't want strong cultures. They don't want strong, chivalrous systems. They want a bunch of twisted, mentally ill people that revel in criminal activity. So that we're all so busy screwing each other over, we never figure out that the entire civilization has been hijacked by the technocrats. I mean, here are two of the articles today. Google honors Maoist who admired Osama bin Laden. I thank Islam for bin Laden. Notice how the communists are always allied with Islam. Asian American revolutionary Yuri, and I have trouble pronouncing her name, but she's famous, the image of the little Mao megaphone, Yuri Kochiyama, looked up to Karl Marx, Mao Zedong, and Osama bin Laden, to name a few. But that didn't stop Google from honoring her on their homepage yesterday. Now, look at this headline over here. Salon romanticizes pedophile masturbating over five-year-old girl. Leftist news outlet plays dreamy footage of child as pedophile discusses sick fantasy. They're mainlining their cult. And they see this guy as a hero because he's willing to come out in the open. A lot of pedophiles also like to torture children and kill them, of course, and is connected to Satanism and all the rest of it. But see, soon you'll be arrested or kicked off Facebook, mark my words, if you criticize full-grown men coming to your door, because under the new system, your children have a right to choose their gender. They have a right, you know, at age 10 to have an abortion. And they have a right when a man or woman comes to the door and says, I'm here to date your six-year-old, to not stand in the way of them taking your child. And the school will, of course, arrange the dates. And the social workers and the police will be waiting down the street. I'm not kidding. Look how much you didn't think would happen has happened. This is their plan at the UN. With NAMBLA. It's right out of the Bible where they come to the door and say, give us your kids, bring them out here. I mean, it's happening. They are coming. They mean business. Pope Francis has declared himself the false prophet of abomination, desolation. In his recent statements to major newspapers like La Croix, Catholic paper in France, biggest one in France, that he doesn't like hearing about Europe's Christian roots and that Jesus was like ISIS telling the disciples to go out across the face of the earth and spread the gospel. Pleased to meet you. Won't you guess my name? My name is Lucifer. Now, I fight fire with fire. We have a lot of news today, but I want to go over this first. The Pope essentially is declaring himself the Antichrist, or declaring himself of Antichrist spirit. Declaring himself the false prophet. Either or, it's all Antichrist spirit. And I've talked a lot about this in the last 2 days, not for lack of news. We have a massive broadcast coming up here today, and I'm about to kick it off officially. But when you have 5 million people brought in, 80% of military-age men, saying they want jihad, and they're attacking Germans, French, and others, the highways have descended into bedlam. They've declared civil emergency on the highways in France. People are being robbed and killed daily. The rapes are epidemic. And they have the Green Party meetings with Muslim leaders on TV saying, soon we will get rid of all of your culture. Blonde-haired, blue-eyed people are bad. And the Germans clap and smile. This is people that have been taught to commit cultural suicide. This is eugenics. This is the so-called leftist death cult. And then after I play this clip that we're going to get to here in a moment, Paul Watson's report, I'm going to play that clip again from Paul Watson's earlier report. And then I'm going to get to salon romanticizing pedophile masturbating over a five-year-old girl. Leftist news outlet plays dreamy footage of child as pedophile discusses sick fantasy. These people are assaulting us. And of course, his name is Todd. And of course, he has a creeper beard and a creeper mullet. I'm not saying you're bad if your name's Todd, but so many of these type guys have the name Todd, and he just fits the bill. I don't know why, what mold they come out of, but I have two daughters. I have a son. It makes my stomach turn to look at him. But we will look at the bullies that dominate our culture because we are so pathetic and lie down to Todd and lie down to Pope Francis. While he pushes socialism and communism and lives behind the shortest walls are 30-something feet. Some of them are 200 feet tall, the inner walls. They have outer and inner. But he says your borders have to be wide open. What a monster. And they're all coming out openly to break our will. This guy is doing nothing more but completing the takeover that the pedophile guild that hijacked the Catholic Church began. And remember, it was in the news years ago when the last pope stepped down, had to go to Gandalf Castle by helicopter, now two popes for the first time ever, that they were blackmailing the Catholic Church with all the pedophilia and Satanism and the rest of it. And the group that was actually doing it all and running the satanic takeover is the group that now took it over. And I traveled to Rome to personally investigate it. And now it's all been confirmed. We actually have a satanic entity publicly inverting the cross, inverting Christ in the seat of the pontiff. There is no debate. This signals the earth moving into an even more dramatic time of open evil. You want to see what end times look like? You're seeing it right now. Now, I'm not saying this is the final end time, because the Bible says there are many antichrists, like waves, leading up to the big one. But I'm telling you, it's the next to the last, or could be the last. I mean, this is dangerous. Bishops should not have to report child abuse, Vatican says. You see, now you notice that Pope Francis took over. No more pedophile talk. No more leftist media attacking the Catholic Church. And it had problems before. But now, now that they've taken it over, oh, now the pedophilia is okay. Now the media takes the heat off because it was mission completed. And they'll use pedophile cults to take over Congress, to take over your state house, to take over your church. This is their main cult, is pedophiles. And it's a big, powerful cult. Rome had them as well. Rome declined when the pedophiles took over. It's beyond that. The pedophilia is only one sign of their devil worship, their evil, of the spirits that control them. And the spirit of our age is a pot-bellied pedophile. I mean, they ought to have a huge statue in D.C. of the pot belly, the little skinny legs, the suspenders, the blue shirt of Todd Nickerson, who's a self-described pedophile, though he doesn't act on it. And everyone should just worship it that worships this modern age. By the way, they've got mainstream news saying little girls that see boys' genitals now in the locker rooms and showers in public schools, down to like, you know, we're talking seventh, sixth grade, they're now putting men in the showers with women. You're like, that's over the top. Of course it's over the top. Because after you put up with this, you'll put up with anything. You better clingers. Let's go to Paul Joseph Watson's report that I am retitling and reissuing with my intro here. We're going to put it back out later today. Pope Francis declares allegiance to Satan. I think that's a fair statement when he says Christian roots are bad and Jesus was like ISIS. He's openly declared his allegiance to Satan. He's come out of the closet as a servant of Baphomet. Let's go to the club.
The Pope says that ISIS's conquest of the Middle East is just like Jesus sending out his disciples. Pope Francis told a French Catholic newspaper, "I don't think there is a fear of Islam as such, but of ISIS and its war of conquest, which is partly drawn from Islam. It is true that the idea of conquest is inherent in the soul of Islam. However, it is also possible to interpret the objective in Matthew's gospel, where Jesus sends his disciples to all nations in terms of the same idea of conquest. ISIS's war of conquest is like Jesus sending out his disciples." Yeah, I must have missed that Bible chapter where Jesus' disciples beheaded people, forced them into sex slavery, and made them pay a tax on pain of death if they refused to convert. The Pope also said he dreaded hearing about the Christian roots of Europe because to him they take on colonialist overtones. Yeah, if it wasn't for the Crusades, which were a defensive measure against Muslim invaders, most Italian women would be walking around in hijabs right now. But don't worry, because the Pope assures us that everything is going to be fine so long as we just integrate the millions of Muslim migrants flooding into Europe. Oh, you mean like the integrated residents of Molenbeek, Brussels, who helped hide Paris massacre culprit Salah Abdeslam for months? You mean like the integrated Moroccan migrants in Cologne who sexually molested hundreds of German women? You mean like the Muslim immigrants across European cities who are so peacefully integrated that police are afraid to even respond to crimes in their ghettos because they'll get attacked? Yeah, how's that integration working out for you? According to the Pope, this integration also includes Muslims interbreeding with Europeans to fix our declining birth rate. Yes, he actually said that. Muslims pouring into the West to breed with Europeans. Now, where have I heard that before?
We will give them fertility. We will breed children with them. Listen to this guy's accent. Because we shall conquer their countries.
Oh, that's right. Radical Islamist preachers who openly advocate interbreeding as a way to conquer Europe. And all this before we even get to the fact that while the Pope lectures Europeans about allowing in millions of Muslim migrants, he lives in Vatican City surrounded by 39-foot walls that were originally built to keep out Muslim invaders. I mean, why doesn't the Pope just start reciting the Shahada and chanting Allah Akbar at this point? Listen up, Popey. Why don't you stop wasting your time washing Muslim migrants' feet, saying how awfully racist Christianity in Europe are, and actually represent your congregation? Why don't you stop lecturing us all about how evil capitalism is? How's that South American socialism working out for you? Not too good, eh? Why don't you actually do something to address the pedophiles that still infest the Catholic Church? Why don't you actually behave like a Christian by defending Christianity instead of constantly undermining it?
And the report goes on. The reason he's doing this is because he's there to hijack Christianity and lead it straight into bondage. He's calling for world government, world taxes, a global cashless society. And notice every other institution is making its move and uncloaking as agents of evil right now because this great battle is now about to be joined. Oh, he wants more immigrants to come to the city of Rome, but none within the gated city walls of the Vatican itself. Incredible hypocrisy. Now, in other news, speaking of uncloaking, Glenn Beck, as I predicted, met with Zuckerberg and badmouthed other conservatives and agreed that they need to be censored, basically, because of all of the evil. That's mainstream news. And Breitbart asks, is he angling for a PR position at Facebook? He's always been a hardcore agent of the left. That's why he uses Christian terminology to manipulate conservatives. He is the definition of Judas Iscariot. He is the Judas goat. Glenn Beck defends Mark Zuckerberg, attacks conservatives. Infowars.com has the report. When we come back, though, the poster man, there he is, the god of Salon, the god of the so-called left. The more deviant, the more sick, they're into it. A king, spokesman, for the love of your children. Yeah, they love them. They're coming for them. And Google honors Maoist who admired Osama bin Laden. They're busy being lectured by Salon now on a daily basis, almost, promoting pedophilia and grown men lusting after your five-year-old daughter. And the UN is trying to legalize pedophilia worldwide with NAMBLA as an NGO. I'm here to tell you, we have to start valuing our lives again, valuing our children again, and valuing real communication, where we don't just sit there and look at Twitter and Facebook all day and pretend we have lives, but where we actually get conscious. Now, we've got our reporters following Trump on the road, and I saw this video last night on Infowars.com. It's amazing footage, and it's the top story on DrudgeReport.com on the upper right-hand side. We'll be playing that video and breaking it down and getting our reporters on today. Even if we got a bump, folks, our reporters come first. We're so humble here at InfoWars, we could literally have space aliens landing in Washington, D.C., shaking hands with the president. It would not be posted. It would not be covered. It would not be discussed. But we're changing that culture and realizing how important the work is our people do. And I appreciate Drudge helping us realize that, as he tells other independent media, realize we are the new media. We're challenging these people. Angry mob surrounds Trump supporter. The woman had a lot of courage. And then below it, boxer feared for her life at anti-dem gathering. And she goes on to say, thank God she had armed security. So she is such an incredible hypocrite on so many fronts that she wants your guns. But before we go any further, since I mentioned it, let's go to the horrifying, horrifying video. Salon romanticizes pedophile. This is an Infowars.com story. Salon romanticizes pedophile masturbating over a five-year-old girl. I'm sorry I have to talk like this. This is what's going on in America. Leftist news outlet plays dreamy footage of child as pedophile discusses sick fantasy. Unless you think we're spinning this, here's their own headline. I'm a pedophile, but I'm not a monster. And then in his new article and new videos, Todd Nickerson. Well, that just sounds like a pedo name out of Central Casting. He comes out and just salivates. Salivates as they mainline. We're people too. Be tolerant of us. Next, it'll be let us teach your kids how we, you know, want them to live. Let us teach your kids about sexuality, which the schools are already doing. Across America, state officials are rebelling, how dare them, against Obama's transgender bathroom decree. And here's the big one. Charlotte Observer, that's the big newspaper. Girls must overcome, quote, discomfort at seeing male genitals in the locker room as they integrate the showers all over the country. This is the mainlining of pedophilia, ladies and gentlemen. Period. And why not? We're such a broke-back nation. We put up with anything. We love to lay down. We love to conform. We think it's liberal to have them jacking with children's sexuality. We think it's liberal to be overrun by scientists who know exactly what they're doing. We're going to go to break, come back, and play this clip. But you know what? Humanity's going to get hit by even worse plagues. Superbugs would kill every 3 seconds by 2050, reports suggest Fox News. And speaking of the degeneracy of the death cult that calls themselves leftist, Google honors Maoist who admired Osama bin Laden. Well, forget admiring bin Laden. How about admiring the greatest mass murderer in history? This lady, you always see her in famous 60s and 70s videos. Yuri Koichiyama. Oh, yeah, she wants the re-education camps, everything. It's her birthday, so they put a sign up saying equality, and the Mao Brigade that comes out and physically attacks us when we protest at abortion clinics, they've got her picture all over their websites. They just love her. They just love her and all their dreams of bloody takeovers. But too bad our founders had a Second Amendment. So it's not going to be so easy here as it was in China and Russia and everywhere else you people been to fill up your fat little tick bellies full of blood as you circle around like demonic buzzards defending the temples that you call Planned Parenthood eugenics facilities. We're going to go to break. By the way, we're running a special that kicks off today through the weekend. It's very easy to get 50% off on the Come and Take It shirt and the Hillary for Prison best-selling shirt. 50% off, $9.95 for these shirts, printed right here in America. When you sign up at Infowars.com/newsletter, just put in your email there and we will send you along with clips, videos, articles, reports, a promo code today and throughout the weekend on the emails, the promo code for 50% off on those t-shirts. I came into that segment and I got angry looking at that guy. And I'm telling you, we need to have a spirit of awakening and getting out of our trance now. Now is the time. Hear those war drums. Get me ready. The sleeping giant needs to awaken. Oh, now they just made him lean forward into the video. You guys make me have a heart attack. I'm talking about, I'm a pedophile, is what he says. And he just is the archetype creep. Out of nightmares that creeps, oh my God. And we're so weak. We're in such a trance now that the enemy has crawled up out of the sewer. Literal vampire pot-bellied goblins are hobbling around coming after us. I'm not against you if you got a pot belly. I'm just saying we always have a pot belly. I had a pot belly until I got in shape. And I'm going to get to that and then all the other news. It just makes me so angry. The article's up on Infowars.com. And this is what Salon, loved by the left, loved by the White House. I am so honored that Salon attacks me almost every day of the year and twists what we say and lies about us and has even called for me to be shut down or arrested. Well, of course you want to arrest me. I don't promote people that want five-year-old girls. I don't promote the Saudi Arabian government either, or Hillary, who protects Bill from all the rape allegations and gives him left cover. But who is the left? They're a bunch of spoiled, rotten, mentally ill people that want to be destroyed. That's what decadence brings. It just brings people that want to be destroyed. Until they're actually being destroyed, then they'll scream. They don't have the moral high ground. They have nothing. These are the parasite controllers now crawling up out of the pit of hell telling us they want our children. It's not enough to abort most of our children. Not enough to sell their body parts. Not enough. In fact, I forgot to cover this. I covered it some yesterday. In a Facebook mentions, but I didn't cover it on air. Can I have the NPR article about, oh my gosh. They're splicing humans with animals now at laboratories. Oh my gosh. Give NPR a Pulitzer Prize. You know, it's even more blasphemous than some potbelly pedophile going after your five-year-old. It is splicing humans with animals and then saying they have no rights. So that's coming up. But here. A video posted on Salon's Facebook page shows a leftist news organization, resident pedophile, Todd Nickerson. You can't make up a name like that. That is exactly what you'd expect the name to be. Todd Nickerson. That's what Stephen King would write. You know, a pedophile's name would be Todd Nickerson, explaining how he masturbated over a five-year-old girl while romanticizing video footage of a child is used to illustrate his sick fantasy. Nickerson first rose to prominence when Salon gave him a platform. They're not just doing this for attention, folks. They do this because it's a sacrament to them, your children, to explain how lusting after children was merely an alternative sexual orientation, close quote, that people should understand and be supportive towards pedophiles. When conservatives dared to express skepticism towards the premise, Nickerson immediately claimed to be a victim of right-wing hate machine in an article entitled, "I'm a pedophile, you're the monsters." And notice the state says, we're going to give your children vaccines without your consent. We're going to have abortions without consent. We're going to take them for sexual training without consent. This is all pedophile induction. Understand? And it's time to tell the left you're not the left. You're monsters. And people they've bullied into supporting them, you're trash, you're parasites, you're scum. We don't go with anything you tell us anymore. Here's another one. Charlotte Observer. This is mainstream newspaper. Girls must overcome discomfort, this is quote, at seeing male genitals in the locker room. People think I'm joking when I get on air and read mainstream news where as girls as young now as the sixth grade are having boys put in the showers with them and vice versa. Man, when I was in sixth grade in sports, you know, up until fifth grade, you didn't take showers and stuff when you were in elementary. Then in sixth grade, you're in there and you go and take showers. And it's a little, you know, weird to, you know, be in there, but you get over it. And but now it's little girls. And they do this openly to test and see what you'll do. I remember like 20 years ago in Kansas and other areas, under federal grants, they would put cameras in the girls' showers and boys' showers of middle school kids, and parents would come and freak out to be on the news. And then it turned out the cameras were hooked into law enforcement databases in D.C. The feds are just looking for what kids they want to grab. Because at the top, folks, the FBI, the CIA, the Congress, it's run by pedophiles. Most of the people you see in top positions and top pundits, you need to understand, they don't just rape children, they murder children. And look at how much of the murders come out. Jimmy Savile and the death and the bodies found in the royal family's palaces and all the dead bodies with the elites here. Folks, raping kids is just the start. They kill them. Satan groups, satanic groups will have women that stay behind closed doors and get pregnant and then, you know, they have babies to kill them as well. I mean, this is who these people are, and they're now coming out in the open. Oh, so a shocking editorial in the Charlotte Observer counsel girls to, quote, get over the discomfort they feel at the sight of male genitals when transgender facilities are allowed in North Carolina. And then it goes on to say they will have people with genitals, penises, in there with them. And, of course, you knew this was coming, and I'm going to get to the pedo video. Somehow this all just is in the same file here at the office. Glenn Beck defends Mark Zuckerberg, attacks conservatives. It's unclear if he's gunning for the role in their PR department in the wake of the Blaze's financial difficulties, but even if it isn't, it's hard to tell the difference. Well, Brzezinski wrote about this in the Technotronic Era in 1974, and this is what Zuckerberg met with the communist Chinese leaders more than 15 times, including their top censor twice in the last 2 years. You will still have conservatives. You will still have Christians. In China, they still have conservative websites. They still have Christian websites, but they're state-controlled with state messages, and only a few are allowed. And he is there gunning at the meeting. And I said this last week, and I said this week. Go back. I told you he would come out prostrating himself, lying down on his little snake belly, rubbing his little pot belly on the ground. And he will sit there and come out and go, you know, Zuckerberg's got to control stuff that's fake news and hateful and bad stuff. And there's a lot of extremism, and I agree with it. Remember, he's the guy, when he was on CNN, saying arrest Ron Paul supporters because they want to bomb the government with a money bomb, years after money bombs were well known that was just a fundraising tactic. And you know, saying I'm dangerous and I'm bad and all this stuff. Folks, he's been an operative all along. His job was to kamikaze the liberty movement. His job was to come in like a political suicide bomber and blow us up. But now we've been alerted to it, shot him out the airlock like the alien species to liberty he is, and he's attached with sucker cups to the front of the ship trying to blow the airlock and take us out. He's got to be dealt with, folks. Just like in the first movie, The Alien. Got to blast him out into space, suck him into the engines, and burn him up. And I don't mean that literally. I wish no harm against this operative. He should be a museum piece someday. But he's activated. He's coming for us. And his main mission was, take me down, as you know. He failed. by the grace of God. Thank you, Lord. But it was rough. He did a lot of stuff behind the scenes, a lot of stuff on the record, and we just took the high road, didn't attack him, prayed that he would stop it, but he didn't. And now he's self-immolated. He's burned himself up in front of everybody. And I'm not going to cook hot dogs on his fire because I like hickory and oak. I don't like roasting hot dogs over a little demonic goblin. So there you have it on that front. But let's get back to speaking of goblins, an even trulier, sickening, Beck's just Judas goading the Liberty Movement. I mean, he's not out there promoting things like this, thank God. I guess he's probably a wonderful person. Let's get to Todd Nickerson. Todd. I think it's the name Todd, but it's just, if I was central casting one of these guys, he would look just like this guy, and his name would be Todd Nickerson. Let's go ahead and go to Todd Nickerson.
And she was just standing there watching me, and I remember looking up and just seeing her and just going, wow, she's beautiful.
Now let's hit pause.
I knew I was in
back it up, back it up. To the start. He's talking about a five-year-old girl here. It's hard to watch. And understand, Satanist, he may not even know he's one, but children of death, children of wickedness, you know, in my view, I'm sure he's not really a wicked person. They are attracted to innocence and defiling it and destroying it. And they want to destroy the free will before the child is developed. And they psychically admit at the higher levels they are vampiring the essence and the innocence of the children off of them and away from them. And so at the lower level, Renfield level, like this guy, at the Igor level, this is just one of their little front minions, you know, that's willing to go out and do all this. He's the tip of the iceberg for the horrible thing right under the surface that's now leering at us and uncloaking. They don't have real relationships with full-grown women. They're scared of big, powerful, you know, steaming women with just all the sinew and the smells and the wild-eyedness. They just, oh, like a man's like, I love this, boy. You know, the more female, the more, just can imagine a woman in like a leopard skin and a club in her hand. You know, it's just awesome. Anyways, that's how God made us. This guy's totally threatened by that and isn't attracted to it. He's attracted to children, people that aren't even sexual, people that aren't even developed, people that don't even have the capability to make another child. Because they're such weak, pathetic slime balls. And now they think we're even weaker than them. We'll go, oh, it's your, okay, we'll drop on by this week then. You know, sir, you can court my five-year-old. No, you can't. But the state, mark my words, I'm serious when I say this. This is already happening in some areas of Europe. Is taking 7, 8, 9. Here it's 10, 11, 12-year-old girls away. If the parents are Christians, won't let them, quote, go to the gay groups. Or won't let them go have a sex change. They say, no, you can do that when you're 18 if you want. They're taking them away. And now it's going to be, and this is what NAMBLA wants, take the children away to put them in to be educated into the love. It's the only way to end the discrimination against pedophiles. That's what he says, too, is we're discriminated against. I mean, in any mammal species, if some male or female comes over to somebody's babies that aren't in their family, starts doing weird things to the babies, chimpanzees will break your neck. Wolves will attack you. I mean, any mammal species protects its youth from aberrant, twisted, malfunctioning, demon-possessed, color out of space creatures like this guy. Here it is.
I remember looking up and just seeing her and just going, wow, she's beautiful. I knew I was in deep. I had fallen for the girl. Oh. The last thing I wanted to do was hurt her.
Oh. Last thing I wanted to do was hurt her. Look at his eyes. I'm not a predator.
I took on a regular babysitting gig. She was 5. She was a precocious girl.
Hit 5. A regular babysitting gig. Don't have a man or a teenage man who wants to babysit your girls or boys babysit. Statistically, they're coming after him. That's why everybody has women. 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 It's known. Now, if you're a brother, they say keep your sisters. That's totally normal. Or if you're a cousin, and then it's like reluctantly, hey, come over and, you know, cook dinner and watch the kids, let them watch a movie. And you're like, all right, you know, that's different. But when it's a guy like this, don't let him around your kids. Let's go back. I mean, that's a no-brainer, isn't it? Let's go back to him.
A regular babysitting gig. She was five. She was a precocious girl. She was advanced for her age. She was also very independent. A lot of my fantasies actually revolve around little girls who are in some way more powerful than I am.
Eventually, they're more powerful. Well, of course, they've got life force. They weren't abused like you were when you were young, I would guess. Statistically, I don't know that about this guy. They weren't inducted into this. I want to know who shot video of this little girl for his piece. They need to be investigated. Who shot video of this little girl that's in this video? If you're a radio listener, there's a little, what looks like 2.5, 3-year-old girl dancing around while this guy drools over her and talks about her life force. By the way, I told you, see? Let's go back to it.
Fantasies actually revolve around little girls who are in some way more powerful than I am. Eventually, my attraction became, you know, overwhelming to the point I had to go relieve myself in the bathroom.
Hey, pause. That's when I want to relieve myself with this guy. And it ain't that way. I tell you, it's a good feeling when somebody comes after you. They almost get you down. You get them down. You got a broken fist. Still a very satisfying feeling. That's the kind of relief I want here. Good boy, I tell you. Oh, but I'm evil. This guy's drooling over children, and I am physically repulsed and physically have a physical response as a man. It's horrible, but people need to know who's coming for us. This is the Democratic Party. Here they are.
When I had to go relieve myself in the bathroom, that's when I had to leave town and get my head straightened out. I didn't abuse her because I knew the harm that it could cause. Also, you know, remembering the fact that I was abused, it's probably contributed to my own sexuality.
Hit pause. I'm going to be honest. Nico asked me this morning, have you seen this? And I said, no, I can't make myself see it more than once. So that's why I'm guessing all this as we go along here, and it turns out to be true. Because I just read some of the transcripts in Paul's article. I didn't see those statements. So see, I'm predicting here. It's not hard to predict. I'm like, look at this poor little guy. See, that's why he isn't as demonic. He's more of a Renfield, like a servant of Dracula. But that's why they put him out there, because he's less threatening to the real demons in the shadows. So the spirit of this guy is what I feel urges to attack. I don't want to attack him. But it just shows that they took that little boy right there, put him into their cult, and now he thinks of love as love between a child and an adult. And whatever age they were abused at is the age they start going after when they are adults. If they got abused at 2, they go after 2-year-olds. If they got abused at 7, they go after 7-year-olds. That's how this works. And they're being left alone, allowed to operate now, folks, and they need to be stopped because they have a mathematic equation. They don't have children. They replicate by abusing other children and expanding their cult. So, again, I normally watch videos before I play them, but stuff like this, I can only look at it once, so that's why. But you know, I'm glad we all watched it together for the first time. Because you saw my predictions be correct. People always ask me, why am I so upset when they're saying get 6-year-old girls ready to see boys in the showers with them in major newspapers, when they are having pedophiles out there saying, you know, I'm not a monster, you know, to normalize and humanize it in a cold-blooded tactic using mental patients, using mentally ill people, in my opinion, like this guy who was abused as a small boy, Todd Nickerson. If you're a TV viewer, look at him showing a picture of himself. He was abused as a 3 or 4-year-old. So now that's what he's attracted to is 5-year-old girls. They have had their sexuality jacked. Now that's only one division. That's the Renfield kind of bumbling, mentally stunted servants of the pedophile guilds in every culture, in every time. Above that is a more cold-blooded manager level, a lot of times isn't even into the pedophilia. And then above that are the vampires. And when I say vampires, they don't live forever, but I think they are possessed and they're into really hurting kids, torturing them, kidnapping them, you name it. And when you look at a lot of, it's come out, the people in the British government, our governments, it's come out, government ministers all over Europe caught with little kids in dungeons, dozens of them dead. all over the world. I mean, this comes out in criminology, but it's not really in the news. It's so horrible that they'll be in little cages, and just the demons, the judges, the politicians, will go and just sit for 10 hours a day with the children just begging and pleading for food and just horrified and their ribs shrinking in. Their favorite thing is starving to death four-year-olds begging for mommy. And then they call it using them up when they finally whimper, give up, roll over, and die. They then have sex with the dead bodies, thank Satan, like Jimmy Savile would do, and go out and grab your next child out of the back of your yard. Now, I'm sorry to have to talk like this, but you need to know who's coming for you and your family. And every instinct in me, I mean, I'll just be quite honest. I start focusing on the enemy, and I get extremely crazed, okay? So, I mean, it's just every instinct in me is just, rah! Just let me into a room with 100 of these people. I'm telling you. And I just don't know where the spirit and the will is to crush the enemy out there. What have they done to us to put us into a trance to put up with this garbage? What have they done to us? What? Again, I'm nothing special, but I see a car wreck, I go help people. Some lady's choking. There's 50 people. Nobody's helping her, saying 911. I do the Heimlich, get the food out. 50 years ago, almost everybody do the Heimlich. I've looked at the numbers. The reports have been documented. We're turning into a bunch of self-centered, walking dead trash. And we're such zombies. We're such self-centered crap that we don't even notice hell itself rising up against us. And my very spirit is just absolutely ready at every level to we're under attack, people. Where is the animating contest of liberty? Where is the spirit lifted up against these people? All right, I'm sorry. I focus in on the evil. It really freaks me out, and I don't get like that a lot, but I know the enemy spirit, and I start talking about it, and it just gets to me because my spirit gets close to that evil, and I feel it, and my whole spirit just goes, They call that crazy. That's not crazy. That's my will, my human spirit saying, crush those that would hurt the innocent. Go after the enemy. Build a civilization. Be honorable. Crush the snakes under your feet. Get behind me, Satan. Now, before I go any further, we got to fund this operation. We got the very best nutraceuticals out there. I don't know if I can run this for another week or so. We want to run it through the end of the month, but that's like 11 days. Because I don't want it to sell out before more gets in. X2, the good halogen, 20% off, InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsLife.com, InfoWarsLife.com. You go there, you get that, the great multivitamin mineral fusion with all the amino acids and everything. Vitamin mineral fusion fruit punch mix is there. InfoWarsLife.com, or call toll free 888-253-3139. Sign up for the free newsletter, get a promo code for 50% off on the Hillary for Prison shirts. It's being emailed out today. Fund us. Give me the energy, and I will attack the enemy. All right, here's the deal, ladies and gentlemen, on this Friday global transmission. I'll be back this Sunday, 4 to 6 p.m., by the way, and I will be in studio doing the show this Sunday. I have been mailing it in a little bit the last few weeks to spend time with my children. Larry Nichols is popping in the next segment to talk about the bold moves of Trump that have put him into the lead in national polls against the rape gang that is the Clintons. Again, a bunch of rapists, a bunch of pedophiles. They're about dominating the human spirit and controlling it. Then we've got Blair White, who is a transgendered individual who is against the whole leftist takeover move that's going on. Thought I'd have them pop in. Peter Schiff on the economy, David Knight. You know, a lot of people ask me if outbursts like that earlier are an act or if they're real. And let me explain what it is. It's real, but I'm letting the dog off the leash. Okay? In fact, let's just say that's about 20% of where the dog can go. Just that little manifestation. And because I'm controlling myself, it is partially fake. And by that, it's not completely natural how angry I really am. I'm holding back there. So it's bona fide, but I am in control. And it's better that I do that on air than sit here and be controlled the whole show and have a heart attack when I'm 50. Because let me tell you something. When I read major newspapers everywhere saying get ready for your 10-year-old and 11-year-old daughters to have naked men in the showers with them at public schools, and when I see pedophiles on TV with Salon saying, hey, I'm a loving, good person, how dare you not like me, it's all part of a cynical takeover move. And I doubt even this Renfield servant of the damned even knows what he's part of. I do know. And quite frankly, I know exactly what I'm talking about, okay? And I mean, it's torture, folks. I know what they're thinking, what they're doing, how they're operating. I know their plans. I can't stand it anymore. I just cannot believe the public has no idea what's all around them. And I've been proven over and over again. I told you back 8 years ago, it was a Democrat operative. 9 years ago. Yeah, it was 10 years ago. Wow, back when, 2007. It's 9 years ago. I don't take pleasure in some other big talk show host being a horrible Benedict Arnold. I want to admire people. I mean, Hannity's been getting better and better, so I've said, good job, Hannity. Limbaugh does a lot of good work. I disagree with his warmongering stuff, but I don't just bash people because I'm mad that they've got a bigger house than I do. I could care less. I care about what's right, and it's painful to look at Glenn Beck's fallen nature and just how evil he is. He loves conning his listeners and viewers. And loves, working for the system to try to lead the Patriot movement into hell. And now that he's failed on Cruz, he's openly running back like Wormer Grimetongue from the Lord of the Rings allegory back to Saruman's castle. I mean, he's with Zuckerberg. I've got the article. Bad-mouthing conservatives in defending Facebook. You knew that was coming. So now they can force-feed him to the Facebook audience. But watch, I predict they're only going to force-feed him in attacks on other conservatives and patriots. They're not going to even promote his so-called empire. And where he really gives himself away is when he brags about how he knows the establishment people and how he meets with them, and how he's going to resurrect himself because he's hiring all these corporate people and the people from American Idol and the guy that made Oreos. He actually is proud of that. I mean, if Trump wins, I'm invited to the White House. I ain't going because of the optics. I'm not with the establishment. Even if Trump turns out to be true, still, I'm not going to the White House. This guy loves the fact he went to the White House to meet with Bush. You're a joke. You think this fallen world, this polished fecal matter, is something to worship. All right, Larry Nichols is our guest for the next 30, 40 minutes or so. Then I'm going to get into economic news, military news, election 2016 news, and so much more. This whole transsexual movement is actually a cover for a pedophile takeover. And I want to be clear, I don't think people that are confused and think they're a man or a woman are bad people. I'm not saying they're even the pedophile movement, okay? Because some people say that none of this ever happens naturally because of chemicals in the water, things that are going on. This does happen even to other mammal species, fish, amphibians, you name it. But it's more than that. In most cases, it's people confusing children about their sexuality when they're young, and it's an excuse to sexualize children, and that's what's going on. With Salon promoting pedophilia, with major newspapers like the Charlotte Observer saying girls must overcome discomfort at seeing male genitals in the locker room, as they now announce from the sixth grade up, all over the country this is happening in different areas, boys and girls taking showers in the locker room together. Folks, this is a total assault. This is another story up on Infowars.com. Trainee Michelle Obama look-alike causes confusion in public restroom. Isn't that an oxymoron to say a trainee Michelle Obama look-alike? Isn't that one and the same? Michael Obama? That's what Obama says over and over again. And I love trolling the mainstream media every time I say that. They pick it up all over the news. Trainee Michelle Obama look-alike thrown out of women's restroom. Incident sparks bathroom debate and discussion over Michelle Obama. That's up on Infowars.com by Kid Daniels. We've got a report on DrudgeReport.com that I'm going to play clips of after our guest leaves us at about 40 after. Angry mob surrounds Trump supporter. It's much worse than that. It's a strong headline, but it's even crazier. Bernie and Hillary backers surrounded a Trump supporter in Lawrenceville, New Jersey, and demonstrated just how little they know about the world. Vile protesters threatened Trump supporters. We can't play a lot of it. There's so much cussing. And it just illustrates the type of garbage we're really dealing with here and how anti-free speech they are. Great job to our crew, Josh Owens and Michael Zimmerman, out there braving the AIDS Skrillex of the world. Now, we also have the Pope coming out in more articles and speeches saying Christianity has bad roots in Europe, shouldn't say that. ISIS is just like Jesus. I mean, you cannot make this stuff up. We're going to be getting into that as well. But I want to cover election 2016 news right now with former Green Beret, a lot of clandestine operations around the world. That's how he ended up getting hooked up with the Clintons and their operations for the CIA there in Arkansas. And he was their handler, helped get him into office. And for many years as they were co-governor and governess. And I'm just recapping his own testimony here. And he's the guy that was behind the Clinton Chronicles and the rape information. And Paula Jones, I mean, there's two people you can say that have been on the Clintons more than anybody. And that would be Matt Drudge and Larry Nichols. There have been a lot of other folks as well. But you could say Chris Ruddy in the early days. But it's certainly Matt Drudge. And it's important to know the history here. And, of course, Larry Nichols. Larry would not be involved in, you know, in the killing of neighborhood kids and things that saw the drugs being shipped in, things like that. So he hit his knees, repented, and now for, I don't know, 25 years, 24 years, has been after the Clintons. And Bill has, you know, even told the New York Times, you know, he's one guy he's scared of is Larry Nichols. He has predicted how they'd steal the election from Bernie or try to. He has predicted that they would, you know, so far not indict Hillary. They're even talking about now, well, if it's classified, you know, how do we indict her and release the emails? So we're going to talk about his latest intel, where he sees all of this going. And the good news here, Trump destroys Hillary in under 3 weeks, now leading in two national polls and more. That's on Infowars.com, an information liberation article. Those are big scientific polls. We'll talk about the providence of those polls in a moment. But he's taking the gloves off, and the Clintons aren't used to this. They say, oh, my gosh, Donald Trump asked good-looking women out at cocktail parties when he's not married. And he told one girlfriend, lose some weight for that bathing suit. Turned out she never said that. So, hey, baby, you're getting a little fat there. That's his crime versus settling rape cases. So we're going to get to the bottom of this right now and tell you what's coming next with Larry Nichols. And Larry is on oxygen. He does have lung cancer. He doesn't like to talk about it. And he is the latter stage and is battling for his life just to stay alive. To fight the globalists. He lost basically everything he had after he went up against the Clintons. He could have gone to Washington with them the whole nine yards. So please keep him in your prayers. And we'll also give out a PayPal at the end of the interview for folks that want to try to get him more of the therapy he needs. And he said it before. If we wouldn't have gotten him the help, you wouldn't have gotten the help, he'd already be gone. He'd like to talk about what he's been through, but this guy has been resuscitated. You name it. He is a tough patriot. And he's in his final real mission for the Republic right now. In fact, Larry Nichols, we ought to have you on sometime just about your experience in the special forces back when they were really special. They're still amazing and see even more combat on average than what you guys saw. But you were actually in Africa and I guess in Latin America and all over a lot of clandestine stuff before you got recruited over into the CIA's Dixie Mafia operation. But, man, I tell you, am I right in saying you're really fighting for the Republic now more than ever? Isn't this the last 25 years your real mission, sir?
You know, Alex, this has been, and I'm sorry about the noise. I normally don't like to have the oxygen on when I do the interview, but
it's okay.
I've got to this time.
It's okay, brother. There's no noise.
This has been, of all the places I've been, of all of the combat action I've been in, there's been nothing tougher than fighting the Clintons politically, fighting the establishment politically, because remember, Alex, you and I were fighting the establishment before it was cool. People didn't believe us that it was all rigged. Well, now they see what we've been talking about. Let's just pray that it's not too late. That's all we can do.
Well, brother, you got the floor here. Let's. I throw a lot of topics. You want to jump into one of those, or what's most important on your screen?
Oh, my God. I heard the commercial coming on where you were talking about, you know, getting prepared. Let me just throw this in right now. As you know, Alex, there are things I know about that I can't talk about because of contracts and such. But, folks, you better get ready. Now, Alex, I don't know what you sell, but I hope the hell you sell stuff people need to have at least on hand, a month minimum, 2 to 6 months, preferably, because this thing's fixing to go down. It's going to go down hard. Just for example, Saudi Arabia, they started paying their contractors with IOUs. Saudi Arabia's banks got their ratings dropped by Moody's. You know why? Connected to the same problem that one of our five major banks has that's going to start cascading in this country. They were so heavily leveraged in American treasuries that it caused their ratings to go down. So I'm telling you guys, it's happening out there. We're the only people in the world that do not know, Alex, the seriousness.
That's right. The global default has already begun. We're putting articles on screen. You're right. It all started 6 months ago with the Royal Bank of Scotland saying sell everything, or 5 months ago. That's why the elite just don't seem to care and are so arrogant now.
That's right. So I'm just saying, just to start the program off, folks, do your family and yourselves a favor. Get supplies, water, food, iodine. I mean,
firearms.
These are the
firearms people need. If you don't have firearms, folks, go get a shotgun, a revolver, go take lessons at the local gun range, learn how to use them. Guns are so easy to use, folks, and you need to learn how to use them.
And just remember this, because I've tried to always tell you all the truth in advance. This thing, when it happens, this country will go primal. And you better be ready. Dear God, you better be ready. Now, on the election front, they're not going to indict Hillary. You know that now. No way. And the thing people don't realize, you see all of this stuff, folks, about Obama's negative ratings, Hillary's negative ratings. Let me tell you, Clinton campaign, and I know because I designed it. The Clintons are not going to try to make you like her. You understand that, folks? The Clintons are not going to try to convince America to like Hillary. That's not going to happen. What they're going to do is they're going to take 60 to 70% of their money, and they're going to use it to make you hate Trump. That's how it will go. Now, that's assuming, of course, 6 days before the convention, Trump still gets the nomination. So I'm just telling you, the Clintons are going to be the damnedest thing. I'm sorry to say that. It's going to be the most. You think Trump's been through it tough. He has no idea what he's fixing to go through when he gets in the general campaign against Hillary. They are going to take him off at the knees, and they've got a willing mainstream media and just about everybody else to help them do it. Now, this is where I come in, Alex. My job with the stuff that I've had all of these years that you know I've had, I'm not going to tell anybody. They're not going to indict Hillary. Somebody out there surely figured this out. If they're not going to indict Hillary over the email scandal and servers and all of that, then why on earth would you think with the things I have that they would be indicting her? They're not. That's not what I'm out to do. What I will do, and I'm trained to do this, and I train them to do this, I will make sure that the majority of the money that they plan to spend to destroy Donald Trump, they're going to have to spend it, Alex, fighting the things I bring out. Now, how am I going to do it when the mainstream's not going to touch it? Well, I guess, buddy, you know how I'm going to do it. I'll be looking at you. I'll be looking at the audience. We're going to have to spread the word. We're going to have to do
it. Well, we've done it with Roger Stone also on their attack on women, because we knew they'd come after Trump with that, and that's been somewhat effective. I mean, the mainstream media, though, is so discredited now. I agree they're ganging up on Trump. They've been caught. But that tends to backfire on them. They're not as strong as they once were, Larry.
They're not as strong as they once were, but you still have to realize if you take all of, and I watch this closely every day nearly, if you take all of the mainstream, if you take all of the 24-hour news networks and you add up their listenership, it comes out to about three, maybe certain hours of a day, maybe 4 million tops audience. But you take the worst TV network during prime time, the worst, ABC, NBC, CBS, the worst one will have 11 million watching some hokey program. Right. Now, folks, I'm telling you, we've got a job to do. We've got a serious job to do. But I'll tell a little quick story. When I was in Nicaragua, I was always amazed. You know, I would get stuff directly from the intelligence committee in Washington. I'd get on a plane. I would drop off out of a plane into Nicaragua. I'd hit the ground. I'd walk miles through the jungle. And when I would get to the camps or to the campesinos, they already knew what I was going to tell them. They already knew. Now, they didn't have radios. They didn't have telephones. They didn't have any of the modern-day communications devices. The closest I could ever figure out is they just knocked on cocoa trees until they passed the word around. But that made me know something that we're going to have to use today. We are going to have to pass the word around.
Person to person.
We're going to have to. Sir?
Person to person.
You bet.
That's why I tell the audience, they are the power. Don't thank me. You're the reason InfoWars is having a huge effect. You're the reason. You are the heart, folks. You are you're the mind, the guts, the bones, the fist. I mean, you're it. Please don't thank me, and please don't ask me to go try to do more. I'm doing everything I can to the point of insanity. Just please realize that you got to get the word out now. You got to tell 100 people a day about the stations we're on. You got to put a billboard up. You've got to call into C-SPAN. You've got to start your own show. You got to file a lawsuit. You got to donate money. You got to go to the city council meeting and just talk about these topics and get a buzz going so big. Because here's the deal. You know your numbers, Larry. Mainstream cable news TV, if you don't count Fox, their average show is about 1.5 million. The others together is only about 300, 400, 500,000. They are a joke. So you're exactly right. Maximum, the average show, 3 million. All cable news together. In the United States, okay? A couple hundred thousand more with Canada. But no one then actually goes out and gets real info. Even though they don't watch it, that kind of becomes word of mouth, what people heard. And the real power the media still has is a talking point, the old media, to put out a talking point that people don't know where it came from. They just heard it. We have to take the InfoWars info, the Drudge info, the World Daily info, the Daily Caller info, and you know other good sites that tell the truth. And we've got to, or your own intel you get, put it out, speak about it, take action, and then word of mouth it. That's the key to the info war. So what do we word of mouth right now, talking to General Nichols?
Well, the first thing you need to talk about is what Hillary's going to do. Hillary's going to get in an aggressive campaign to discredit Trump. And Alex, I'll add to what you said. Folks, when you start this word of mouth campaign, there's two things you better remember, two rules. Number one, know your source. Don't be afraid to say, I heard it on InfoWars, Alex Jones.
Yeah, be proud. The key is be confident. Drugs. The key is That's be confident. Right. We're in a war, They're a death battle, folks. Get confident.
That's right. They're going to come at you and they're going to say, they've heard that Drudge or Jones or WorldNet, they're nutbags. That's what they've heard. You stomp on
You say
that.
You owe it to yourself to go see the truth. Don't let That's the mainstream right. media, you know they lie. Go find out for yourself. America's find in trouble. Let's wake up and come in together.
Make them come and, hey, just tell them this. Look, I tell you what, I might be lying. Just do this. Go to InfoWars, watch Alex Jones for a week, and then come back and tell me. Second thing, what you pass on, you make sure that it is sourced and that it is true. Don't go taking something you heard from Joe Blow on the street.
That's why they put out disinfo sites on purpose to say wild stuff so that we get discredited.
You have no idea the disinformation machine we had with Bill Clinton in Arkansas back when I was there, and it's worse today. Watch these emails that you get from other people and go passing it around as though it were true. Source it out. If you're going to get somebody to join us in this battle, you make sure what you tell them is true. And you do those two things, and folks, I guarantee we're going to bring people in. The next thing you need to tell people, what's coming? See, that's paramount. Tell people what is coming ahead of time, but be smart. Don't go telling them the crazy stuff that you hear about the sky's going to fall on the 17th of May or whatever. Tell the stuff that's coming. Look, read the signs. You know, Alex, learn to read the signs. There is something wrong when Saudi Arabia, right? When Saudi Arabia starts having to pay IOUs for their contractors, Saudi Arabia's got oil out the kazoo. What happened? You know what happened to Saudi Arabia, folks? Iran. See, the part of the Iran deal that people are now finding out was all a lie, that big deal that they made, part of the Iran deal was Obama would facilitate allowing Iran to dump their oil at $25 a barrel or less when Saudi Arabia and OPEC was getting $40 to $45 a barrel. And now you've got ships. I got tickled about this. I guess tickle's not the word. You've got oil ships, freighters stuck out in the Mediterranean. Just sitting there. Now, guess what? Goldman Sachs earlier this week, Alex, put out a press release saying the oil glut's over. No, it's not, guys. No, it's not. Goldman Sachs is part of the machine. They're part of the system. And when they put stuff like that out, you'll be amazed at how many people fall back to sleep. And they think, well, guess what? It's over. No, it's not. And then on the Hillary front, oh, Lord, you've got the Juanita Broderick stuff that's starting to resurface. That's going to come out. Let me tell you some stories that you need to know about Hillary. When Bill was president and when he was running for president, now this is coming out, by the way, Alex, and I hate to say it, but who I can use, National Enquirer, in the next week or so. There's going to be another article come out by me or about me, and I talk about two things. Number one, Hillary going, when Bill was governor, about every month to 6 weeks, Hillary would go out to L.A., and she would go to a church for witches. Witches.
By the way, Tex Mars, I remember, actually had copies of the local paper, her at the witchcraft ceremonies. So
she literally, this is documented. She did go. It's not a joke. Now, the other thing, when Bill was running for president and when he was president, they were fighting me, because I was the one with, quote, unquote, the bimbos. I was the one that brought out the women. Nobody else did. Hillary headed up personally what was called the bimbo eruption. It was Hillary. She was in charge of putting down, smearing any woman that I dared to bring out. She was the hammer. So Hillary was the facilitator. She wasn't the victim. She wasn't the one that, oh my God, when Bill told me about Monica Lewinsky, I just cried and thought, my God. She knew about all of it.
So to be clear, the National Enquirer, with you as a source, you're the original confirmed source, you're exposing her witchcraft behavior and her coven in Los Angeles, and it's coming out about the bimbo eruptions.
That's right.
Well, look, now, the Enquirer, people confuse it with News of the World, with, you know, Bat Boy. The Enquirer does tabloid stuff and gossip, but it's incredibly accurate compared to mainstream media.
It is. And I have found them, to be honest, more truthful in covering me and actually getting the story straight that I tell than anybody else in the printed media, to be honest, other than like Matt. But that's coming out. Use that. That's not some crazy story. And it will be significant because Hillary, her big thing that Trump's going to attack her with is she did know what Bill Clinton was doing.
And she was the one that honchoed the cover-up. Stay there. Larry Nichols straight ahead. A lot more. Larry Nichols is our guest. I got some Trump clips I want to play while he's here with us, and then more Trump clips after he goes. Briefly, our all-time best-selling shirt now is the two different variants, limited editions, of Hillary for Prison. I put one out. It was very popular. It ended. People started copying it. Folks wanted it back, so we tweaked it a little bit, but it's basically the same shirt. We follow the letter of the law because I always do what I say I'm going to do. And brought back this limited edition shirt with a tweak. On the back, Infowars.com is in red instead of white, and it says legalize freedom. And on the front, it says Hillary for prison 2016, and then under it, till the end of time. So that's the difference in the shirt. It's very, very popular. We got a big shipment in of them just a few days ago. And we are offering 50% off. They're printed right here in the United States. 50% off. But you've got to go to Infowars.com/newsletter. Infowars.com/newsletter. And there's also a site on the front page of Infowars. Just put your email in. We will send you the promo code at checkout to get 50% off the Hillary for President shirt. Now, maybe you already have one. You want a Molon Labe. It's in English. It's the come and take it Texas version. That shirt is 50% off as well. That runs through Sunday with the promo code that we're going to give you when you sign up for the newsletter. And listen, I never did this smart. I've been on air 21 years. I was smart about trying to get the word out, but not foreseeing censorship. With all the Facebook and Twitter censorship and the rest of it, the tech experts say, listen, new tech is old tech. You want to have contact with all your hardcore patriots. So even if they shut down InfoWars or Prison Planet for a time during, you know, internet control or kill switches, email will be next to near impossible to shut down unless they turn the electricity off. And we are super lacking. I never promoted Twitter. I never promoted Instagram. So, you know, we've got like 4 or 5 million people on Facebook that follow our different channels. And we've got tens of millions that tune in every day on different platforms and millions of subscribers on YouTube. But when it comes to a few areas, we are basically in the negative. We are not doing good. We're flat-footed. We need to be able to stay in contact with you. Create a new email that's just for us to communicate. I don't care. Your old email, whatever. Go to Infowars.com/newsletter. Put in that email. We send you exclusive articles, videos, promo codes, coupons for the shopping cart, the store. We do use it for marketing and funding our operation. But the flip side of that is staying in contact with you. Infowars.com/newsletter. We don't share your email with anybody. It is essential we be able to stay in contact with all the patriots out there. We'll send you the promo code to get 50% off on one or more of the shirts. We almost lose money on that deal, but it's so exciting at the Trump rallies and everywhere to see every 10th person wearing a Hillary for Prison shirt or a Molon Labe shirt or a Come and Take It shirt. So take advantage of that today. Infowars.com/newsletter. Finally, we have the vitamin mineral fusion that took us 2 years to develop with one of the top nutraceutical producers in the country. It's a game changer, totally natural, healthy, organic, plant-derived, full spectrum minerals, amino acids, vitamins, and more. And it's got a lot of fancy stuff in it. Just go to the site, read about it. It's got a lot of amazing things in it. It's got the proper organic form of vitamin B12, methylcobalamin. It's got other things in it as well, like coenzyme Q10. There's too much to list here. It is the best multivitamin mineral out there to absorb into your body. That way you drink it with the saliva in your mouth. It actually gets broken down. You actually get it into your bloodstream. It's so amazing. If you want to boost that even more, vitamin B12, Secret 12, under the tongue, and InfowarsLife.com. Especially for older folks and people, there's such a vitamin B12 absorption problem in the gut. And then lastly, we're running this special as long as we can, hopefully in the next week, but it is very popular. X2, the good halogen, nation iodine, 20% off, InfowarsLife.com, or call toll-free, 888-253-3139, 888-253-3139. It's got 4.8 stars out of, 1,313 reviews on Power Reviews, a third-party site. I mean, it is the ultimate true pure iodine that doesn't burn your stomach and the rest of it. But still, consult a physician, because if you already got thyroid problems and you're too far gone or whatever, just consult your physician. Consult your physician before you breathe oxygen either. I mean, I could say before you take a walk in the park. The point is that look into it for yourself and be sure and read the insert there. But it is all generally seen as safe and good. And you die without iodine. The problem is there's just hardly any of it that's pure out there, and it's got problems with folks that have never really had it. You're so full of the bad ones in your thyroid and other glands that when it hits sometimes and things happen, you can have some toxic effects, you name it. I mean, you know, the road from hell back to heaven is not an easy one, is it? Okay, back to Larry Nichols. Larry, I want to play some clips here of Trump. I want to talk about other big things that are coming. But no, I agree with you. It's uncanny. I see elites running to New Zealand, armored redoubts, stock markets plunging around the world, big companies defaulting, and Saudi Arabia having to borrow $10 billion a week to pay payrolls. They were supposedly the richest country in the world. Millions of refugees pouring in, sleeper cells, the elites weaponizing media, just all sorts of craziness. What is the real state of the world from your DC sources? I have some of the same sources, but I mean, I think we've had a point where the elite themselves are now forgetting about control. They're putting up a facade of control while they steal as much as they can, as fast as they can. Is that an accurate statement?
That's absolutely accurate. You know, Alex, guys, you'll notice that I've spent the majority of this program not talking about Hillary. Hillary will come. That will come. But what is impending right now? What's coming right now? We are, well, I've always done this. See that? See that distance right there between my thumb and forefinger? That's how close we are to this baby collapsing. You better be ready. And you better.
By the way, I've been interviewing you for 21 years. You're one of the first interviews I ever did on radio, Larry. And I've never heard you say collapse. I mean, you never got into economic stuff. I mean, what's going on?
Well, if you know what I unfortunately, maybe fortunately know, you'll see exactly what's coming. And that's why I tell people, Alex, tell you, or ask you to tell your audience, read the signs, these things going on around the world. Remember, we're usually the last ones to know. But it's coming, and it's coming hard, and it's coming fast. I'll tell you one other thing. Folks, you're not getting anything on your money in the bank. We're in the middle, Alex. Even people in Washington, a couple of senators I know well that you know, have even told me, you know, Nichols, you were right. We are in the beginning of the end of the soft coup, a silent coup, soft coup. That means our government's fixing to change. They're afraid it's fixing to change. Now, here's what happens when a country starts to change. First thing is you've got in the banking area, you've got nationalization. Guys, I've been in four countries. Two of which I was a part of the thing that helped make them go into the coup. But I'm in four countries, and in each country, three things happened. First was the nationalization of the banks. That's going to come when the nasty secret from the major bank comes out. Now, I think if you look at Puerto Rico, imagine this, Alex. What if one of the five major banks in this nation held a disproportionate share of the 107 million, which is just the payment they defaulted on, of Puerto Rico's debt, and they belly up? Now think about that. So what happens when it gets that critical? The country, the government comes in and nationalizes the banks. You say, well, that can't happen. I'm sorry, didn't they just do that with healthcare? Our fifth largest thing in the country, they did it there. They come in, they nationalize the bank. Second thing is negative interest. Now, I hear people all the time saying, well, boy, I hope we get negative interest. My house payment will go down. No, negative interest does not mean your house payment's going to go down. Negative interest is a political term for once the banks are taken over by the government.
They're going to charge you to keep money in your bank and do bail-ins.
You got it.
And the bankers are going to give all themselves the stimulus money. It's
now,
absolute robbery.
The third thing is repatriation, Alex. Repatriation. That's when they take your money. That's when you go to the bank, as Brazil, as Greece, as Portugal, as several countries have done. You go to the bank to get your money out, and they say, I'm sorry, we just can't do it. You know, in Greece, they allow you today, still today, you can only take $37 a week out. I don't care if you got $1 million in. Those things are coming. So let me ask you this, Alex. I don't know. What do people make putting their money in a bank now? I mean, a percent maybe or whatever interest. I would get my money and get it to where I can see it, where I can hold it, because that's what's going to happen. You're going to have cash. And by the way, if you don't think you better get the foods and supplies today for the day this happens, has anybody been been around, like in Arkansas, maybe Texas is the same way, Alex, when a snowstorm's coming, you know, you hear on the news and weather a storm's coming, go to the grocery store a little bit late and you go to the aisles and the aisles are stripped bare of bread and milk and such. Well, think about this. When this happens, it'll be amazing how fast the grocery store shelves will empty. So I suggest that you listen to me real tight. And you better understand, I don't bluff and I don't kid, especially about something like this. You better get the supplies you need. Now, I don't know if you sell them, Alex, or somebody else does. That's somebody else's business other than mine. But you better get them.
No, I hear you. I hear you. Well, Larry, you're about to leave us. I want to get you back up in the next few weeks. Overall, we've been praying for you. You look pretty good overall. I know you've been through a lot. I'm going to put up on screen for folks. You don't even ask for this, but if people want to try to support you so you can keep getting the medical attention you need, the last 20-something years, you've given up everything you had. You were very successful to expose these people. I talked to the Clinton Chronicles folks. You didn't even ask for money to be in those films that sold millions of copies. Wish you would have. You wouldn't be in this position. Yeah. But Nichols Live at AOL.com, Nichols Live at AOL.com, and we try to help Larry out a little bit, too. We went up there and interviewed him. You know, helped him a little bit with his chemo and stuff. But Nichols Live at AOL.com, or you can write to him at 58 Kingsington Drive, Conway, Arkansas, 72034, and also pray for him as well. Nichols Live at AOL.com.
And Alex, I got to say one thing in closing. What you're talking about, people getting in with the emails to you, that is phenomenally critical. They have got to sign up and get on the email list. And I'm not doing this to promote Alex. I'm telling you, we've got to have a way to get direct communication.
That's right. Even when they shut most of the web off, which they admit, remember they would deny Obama's internet kill switch, and then they said, no, it's real. We put it in 5 years ago. The email, though, is so digital, it'll still be able to be sent basically over phones and things, so we can then get that list if we have it, and still, hopefully, through some other systems, we have some stuff set up in Europe, some stuff set up in Latin America, to let everybody know. We're still going to be able to try to email you. So we're actually getting ready, folks. I'm getting storable food and things built up here at the office and medical supplies and things because the elite are doing it. Larry Nichols, God bless you. We'll talk to you soon, my friend.
Thank you, buddy. See you.
Thank you, sir. Look, I want to explain something here. I was on air in 1995. I was on radio by 1996, syndicated by 1997. And I missed the boat. I thought Y2K was a total fraud. And you go back to my earlier shows, you hear that. The Navy said 40 states would collapse. The government put the reports out. Congress did. And I said, this is an excuse to have billions to these tech companies to replace all the chips and telecommunications so that the NSA can spy on people. That's what NSA insiders told me, like Wayne Madsen and others. But then as the hype built up a few months before it, I took sponsors. I got ready. I started to believe it because everybody was saying it was an absolute. It had to happen. And then my gut was right. It was a fraud. I mean, there was some problems and things, and there was some issues in computers, but you just reboot them. But it was an excuse to get all this updated tech in, this smart grid of control. It was part of that. It was an NSA takeover worldwide to get the new tech in place because a lot of stuff wasn't compatible. It was an upgrade covered in hysteria. And by the end, just under the hype and peer pressure, and I was a lot younger then, I bought into it. And it was a fraud. I don't want to think this collapse is real. I don't want to believe it's happening. I'm in the middle of it, too. But there is defaults happening all over the world. There's pension funds being grabbed. They're grabbing people's bank accounts in Europe. The same globalists run that. They're making preparations here. They're trying to pass laws in Congress saying that. They have passed laws to grab your pension funds. And so we've gone from this being a possibility to a probability. Now, I don't know how bad the crash is going to be, but it's already started around the world. So absolutely, do I try to then sell storable food and water filters and things? Because I'm already doing that myself to be prepared. That's what normal folks do. It's what Boy Scouts do. Not trying to fund us off doing what I believe in? Absolutely. So there's no guilt there. You know, the media will spin it and go, look at you selling water filters and food while the elite are all storing food and you know, drinking filtered water because they know what the water's already so poisonous. I say filtered water because of what's already in it. Every day I see like 10, 15 articles about Texas or Ohio or Michigan or California and, you know, all the lead, mercury, and arsenic and how toxic it is. I mean, that. But you see what's going on in the derivatives and the buildup and the armored vehicles getting delivered locally and Soros trying to cause a civil war. I don't know what the trigger's going to be, and I pray every day that we somehow make it out of this, somehow things don't go to pot, somehow things don't unravel with all these wars and menacing Russia and menacing China and all the stuff that's going on. I hope every moment that I'm wrong. But you know what my gut tells me, and it's never wrong? It says you shouldn't even be here right now. You should be taking whatever little money you got out of the bank. You should be getting more storable foods. You should be getting more vitamins and minerals stockpiled. You should be getting medicine stockpiled. You should, and that's what I'm doing. You should be getting ready for a long-haul depression. And you should be getting a place even further out in the country off some dirt road somewhere. I mean, my gut, that's never been wrong, tells me I'm in deep trouble and I need to get geared up for my family. Now, sometimes you get a big scare and you realize that it was a close call. Your gut was right, but things went okay. I hope that's the case. But yes, if people don't go to InfoWarsStore.com, which has the very best storable foods, the lowest prices out there, and get a 4-week, a 3-month, a 6-month, a year food supply, if you have the funds to do it, I think you're crazy if you don't, because you can eat your investment if, thank God, you don't need it. But they pushed the whole Y2K thing, I now realize, years ago, as a way down the road with real emergencies they had planned to discredit prepping. But prepping's hotter than ever because people instinctively see how unsustainable this civilization is. We are back live. I am your host, Alex Jones. Look, here's the deal. The globalists have a worldwide plan where they've engineered theft and collapse as a sexy, cool thing to have a post-industrial world to save the Earth from modern civilization. That's the cover story, the feel-good story, the cosmology that they give high-level controllers as a mental narrative to follow. And then they have the mid-level minions and operatives that also pick up that agenda. Below that, they tell people that doesn't exist, you know, it's crazy. There's no world government. There's no new world order. But then in the publications and things at Whole Foods and stuff, they say it's good to be poor. It's good to have nothing. It's good to have a low carbon footprint. You're going to have nothing in the future. It's sexy to have nothing. It's sexy to be sterile. It's sexy to not have kids. It's sexy to just roll over and die because we, the elite, are going to inherit the earth. It's sexy that Germans have no kids, basically, and we're going to bring in jihadis. They're going to rape and kill you, and you're going to thank us for it. And then on TV, the Germans go, yes, we are scum. Thank you. Ah, you know, we're in a cult. Germans, you know, can say invent a lot of stuff. They're smart people. But culturally, they follow orders. That's why you can say they're real good at in engineering and factories and, you know, warfare and stuff. But I guess all the free-minded Germans must have moved over here or something. And I guess the folks that follow orders stayed in Germany. All I'm saying is I'm part German. That's not my instinct. And, of course, I mean, you could sit there and say Germany's been mixing and, you know, with all other folks in Europe. That's why Hitler, the consummate eugenicist and racist, thought that England was the holy land of his, you know, pure Aryan race and all the rest of it. But the point is, we're under scientific attack. But even the globalists don't follow their own brainwashing. They claim they've got organized theft, organized control, but they themselves are stealing as fast as they can. Even though it's going to bring down their own system, they can't help it. But they're smart, so they realize they better build airfields and helicopter pads in rural areas of the Ozarks in the U.S. or rural areas of New Zealand or rural areas of Australia or rural areas of Western Europe. They are digging in. And so that's the most concerning sign we see. Now, there's a bunch of Trump clips I haven't gotten to yet. I want to start playing some of those ahead of our next guest joining us. But let's go ahead and go to this clip. Trump, Hillary is proud of NAFTA and wants TPP. Yeah, what is there to be proud of with the TPP? We're going to go to break with more.
He signed NAFTA. NAFTA is one of the worst trade deals ever made by any country at any time. It has cleaned out our country. It has cleaned out our country of jobs. You take a look at New England. Take a look at upstate New York and Pennsylvania. And take a look at Maryland, where I just left. And take a look at every place. We've been cleaned out by the worst bill, economic development bill, or whatever you want to call it, ever. Mexico is taking our jobs. They're taking our factories. Look at what's happening with China. And Hillary likes people, you know, the Trans-Pacific Partnership deal is going to be worse, in my opinion, worse, if that's possible, than NAFTA. And Hillary Clinton wants it. And so does Obama want it. It'll be a total disaster for our country.
She calls it the gold standard, but now she says there's problems with it.
Well, no, she wanted it so badly, and now she sees that I'm against it. So she went and studied it, and now she says, oh, maybe he's right. So maybe now she's going against it, but that's only
the worst thing. No, she's not going against it. She's saying Bill is really smart and that Bill will run the economy. She said that back on like Monday or Tuesday. Trump knows that this is by design a screw job, but he knows they'll call it a conspiracy. He should say foreign nationals and foreign groups have had a corporate coup in America. Globalism is a one-sided street to consolidate control and deindustrialize us. And then the political class wants us all poor so they can control us, but they make the money off the Chinese slave factories and the Mexican sweatshops. That's what's really going on. It's not a failure. NAFTA and GATT is a great coup over America, just like the EU is over Europe. It is a huge success. All right, I don't know how much of this we can play ahead of our next guest joining us. But the story's up on drudgereport.com. And it, of course, deals with the insanity going on as our reporters are on the East Coast. Angry mob surrounds Trump supporter. Here is just some of the video and audio I can play. I can't play much because it hasn't. There's so much beeping we'd have to do. Because most of the Hillary and Bernie supporters, as you know, only know like maybe if 6 or 7 cuss words. Or you're a white male, if they're white, even though they're white male. So you can't speak if you're a white male, even though you can speak if you're a white male. So let's go ahead and turn to that. We'll back that back up and play some of this.
Here's this Muslim woman. Audio.
Here's this Muslim woman who wouldn't even be allowed, if your TV viewer, you can see this, who wouldn't even be allowed to be out in public if she wasn't in the United States and most Muslim countries. And then now she wants to sit here and tell this other. But there's so much cussing, we can't play it. I was told there was a few clips we could play, right? Oh, yeah, the Nazi clip. Yeah, let's play that. It's so original. But if you're against the EU, they say you're a Nazi, even though the Nazis set up the plan for the EU. So, see, if you're George Soros, an actual Nazi, then you get to call everybody else a Nazi. But if you aren't a Nazi, then you know, you have to sit down and be called one. Let's go ahead and go to this clip.
Hey, how are y'all doing? Yeah.
How you doing, buddy?
Good. Got anything to say? So Trump's a Nazi, right?
Yep. Yeah.
Wow. Was Trump a Nazi?
He likes to scapegoat minorities. He wants to attack the Bill of Rights, the First Amendment, Fifth Amendment, due process of law for immigrants.
It is kind of concerning how he was talking about freedom of the press. You know, he's saying he's going to go after news organizations that say bad things about him. You know, that's...
Yeah. He wants to increase the libel laws, and he's got a reputation for that, attacking people.
Yeah. So do you think Trump is Hitler-esque? I mean...
I think he's Hitler in 1929, before Hitler came to power, as he was building his movements.
Right. Do you have anything?
I mean, I agree. I feel like he's following the playbook, definitely. He hasn't gotten to the point of Hitler yet, obviously, but he's definitely... trending all the same things, scapegoating minorities, you know, turning complicated issues into easy solutions, which essentially involve just getting rid of people that he doesn't want. So,
do you foresee Trump, you know, committing some act of genocide like Hitler, though?
Maybe not to the form. I mean, I don't think he's going to kill anybody, but I mean, he's talking about mass deportation, no due process, just getting rid of people. I mean, that's not a solution. And
well, he's nuclear weapons. So that's a form of genocide, I would
exactly
say.
What
if you want to use nuclear weapons?
What is want to use nuclear weapons?
Essentially, they blamed all the problems on the poor people and scapegoated.
All right, let me comment on this now. This is the only group that could actually talk, so that's why we're playing it without cuss words. You notice Zimmerman, you know, brings up a smart reporter. Real issue with Trump. On some of the things he said about the press and libel laws. Though, I don't know, I'm the victim of MSNBC saying, influence the Boston Bombers with no proof, or I'm deeply racist. I mean, I could win a suit on them. But regardless, Trump says some stuff I disagree with. I mean, I'm not going to agree with somebody 100%. But Mexico and all these other countries have borders and strong immigration laws and, like, torture people and forced labor them, which I don't agree with if you're Guatemalan and come into Mexico. But here, they're advertising, get everything free, have your baby for free. We're going bankrupt. Trump points that out. He's not scapegoating immigrants. He doesn't hate immigrants. He says he loves immigrants. Then he's criticized for hiring immigrants that are legal. So it's a fraud. Just like they say, you know, that he wants to kill Muslims or he wants to ban Islam. It's Islam in its current form that wants to ban everybody else's religion. So it's the attempt to put him in the light of this just incredible monster. And then you virtue signal with your little Trump sign that he's a Nazi. And then you go out and hold up your sign when our elite have killed 300,000 people with their proxy army in Syria. Our elite have overthrown Libya. Our elite are funding radical Islam. Our elite are selling baby parts. Our elite are so close to Hitler, they're eugenicists. That I'm just so sick of these mindless, well-being liberals and just coming out and just bumbling around with their idiocy. I mean, look at this woman. She's helpless. All right, folks, we are back live. We've got Peter Schiff of Euro Pacific Capital joining us on all the big developments in the economy coming up at the bottom of the hour. Then we have, is it David Knight hosting the fourth hour today? Yes. Also, I've got other news I want to get to that I've mentioned. Google honors Maoist who admired Osama bin Laden on their big official front page yesterday on the birthday of China's Cultural Revolution admirer. Just days after China's Cultural Revolution 5th anniversary that killed 84 million people, they promoted the iconic image of the young Maoist herself of Japanese background, basically praising that whole situation. Simply incredible to see things like this. Google honors Maoist who admired Osama bin Laden, Asian American revolutionary Yuri Koshiyama looked up to Karl Marx, Mao Zedong, and Osama bin Laden, to name a few, but that didn't stop Google from honoring her on their homepage Thursday. Again, these are rich capitalists, hundreds of billions of dollars, one of the top five companies in the world, hooked in with the White House. And Obama comes out a few months ago in South America and Argentina and says, oh, we need communism to work with capitalism, but capitalism will be multinational. Up above the nation states will be communist. So you'll be in a slave pit in the people's paradise. We'll kill you if you want to, but we'll be multinational on jumbo jets. We'll have cars. We'll have air conditioner. We'll have red carpets. You will have nothing. And look, here's your icon. Always the rich elite promoting communism because it's only for you. They're exempt from it. Warren Buffett, the biggest recipient of the banker bailout, was the biggest promoter of it. Just type in Warren Buffett, the biggest recipient of the banker bailout, was the biggest promoter of it. That's the headline with McClatchy. Perhaps I flipped it. The biggest promoter was the biggest recipient was the actual headline. Same thing, same difference. So we're at this crossroads. These people are so monstrous. They don't want you to have enough money to be free market and to make your own decisions. They want you so poor they control your life. Now, our next guest is almost the bottom of the hour, Blair White. And perhaps we should get her on from time to time to, you know, give some balance to all this because it's like Camille Paglia. I remember my dad, when I was a teenager, knew that I was a big history buff. So he said, you ought to read this book. I forget which one of her books it was, but it made a lot of sense. And, you know, she's what I'd call a real liberal. I mean, she's for more freedom, more openness, a more open society, but doesn't want to ban words and tell you how to think and tell you what to do and go around persecuting everybody. He's a big critic of folks attacking Trump and others and third wave, quote, feminism. But look, first wave had a lot of good issues in it because those issues were already there. It was hijacked by Edward Bernays. That's been declassified, and the OSS, then the CIA, to end the family and to break down independent free culture. So there are a lot of diverse people in all these movements and groups, but what's driving it? And so now they come out and they claim anyone who smiles at a black person is racist. Anyone who doesn't smile is racist. Or if you don't use the proper term of what you're supposed to call people, you're racist. And that's always changing. To always make you guilty, always make you bad. And a clip she wants us to play, Blair is a social and political commentator that focuses on feminism and social justice. She's also transgender and enjoys debunking the liberal fallacies about transgenderism that have become the mainstream narrative. And regardless what you think of this, they've only chosen this movement as their new civil rights movement to promote the government coming in my view, and starting a gender debate that they want to define. So it's about the government being the parents and controlling the culture. And that's undebatable in my view, but we'll talk about it. But who says that the radical, crazy left over at Salon promoting pedophilia on a weekly basis now, how does that speak for you? So there's also this whole moral signaling thing where these groups claim they speak for everyone. So it's a very, very dangerous situation. And one clip she wanted us to play was, her YouTube site's youtube.com, Blair White, or /Blair White, or Twitter, MS Blair White, or msblairwhite.com. But there's another clip we have here that is from Tumblr Vomit. This is Blair White commenting. Blair provides counterpoints to a trans activist Tumblr video. All straight people are transphobic. See, that's the issue. If you're straight, you must be bad. It's not that you're tolerant or don't care or live and let live. Now, mother and father existing, or he or she on an entrance form, that may hurt someone that now you're not even a he or she. It's not just identify how you want. It's that any identification is bad. And that's where this is going. It's a very asexual, very bland, controlled environment, in my view. And that's what the social engineers admit they're doing. We're going to our guests in a moment. But here is part of that breakdown where this person says that all straight people are transphobic. Everything is sexist, racist, homophobic. Only those denouncing everyone are high and mighty and good. This is a cult. If a straight person says they're not transphobic, they're lying and cannot be trusted. Microaggressions, etc. So that's where this is going. Let's play the clip.
All cisgender people are transphobic, just as all men hold misogynistic views and all white people are racist.
Where have I heard that before?
Everything is sexist, everything is racist, everything is homophobic.
All cisgender people are transphobic.
I mean, what a shitty world to live in, like painting the world around you as always racist, always transphobic, always misogynistic. Is there no silver lining with these people?
I've known that I'm trans for 5 years, and I still sometimes struggle with internalized transphobia. Thoughts that maybe I am a freak.
Aha, you're projecting. Just because you think you're a freak doesn't mean everyone around you constantly thinks you're a freak. Calm down.
If you tell me that as a cisgender person, you are not transphobic, you are telling me not to trust you.
Oh my God. So, you only trust someone who tells you they are transphobic. Because that's them repenting for their sins, right?
By telling me that you are not transphobic, you're telling me that you are unaware or choose to live in the dark about the way that we are socialized in a Western society.
Okay, so what this is an attack on Western society, and that no matter how tolerant and open someone is, they can never prove themselves proper to the high priestesses and priests who will always expand what is offensive and what words they want to ban or restrict. These are people in the whole political correctness, social justice warrior movement that want to control reality. This is a weaponized globalist program, declassified, to do this. Now, it takes over other movements and other groups and other things, but at its core, this is what it's projecting, in my view, and from our research. And so I want to go to our guest now, but just imagine where this just never stops. No one can ever just be left alone. You've got to be told because you're white or you're Western or you're male, you're inherently bad. Well, that is inherently classist, racist, bigoted at its foundation, because any dumbed down intellectual movement is going to be based on that. So this is the product of our dumbed down society, the lowered IQ, all of it. And this is the type of weaponized media we face. Blair White, thanks for coming on. I mean, you've heard my comments on this. I saw your video and, you know, thought it was, you know, thought-provoking, because, I mean, this is inside the whole debate. It seems like these people are bullies trying to order everyone to just do exactly what they say. But even if you submit every week, they're updating the new thing you must do. But even if you do that, you can't help the fact, because you're, I guess, white, you're inherently evil.
Absolutely. You know, one of the reasons why I started my channel was because I was tired of being co-opted by these people. I think that unfortunately they've gained a monopoly on, you know, anything to do with transgenderism. And it was just really frustrating for me. So I wanted to start my channel and sort of just provide just a different narrative, because unfortunately their way of thinking and their way of looking at, you know, trans issues and anything in the world has become the mainstream narrative. And if you go against it, then you are blacklisted, basically.
We see a radicalization here, just like with Islam, where the most radical get in control. So they're always one-upping each other on who can be the most extreme. Do you think that's kind of what's happening here? And also, who is the fountainhead of all this? Where is all this extreme acceleration of rhetoric coming from?
I really don't know. I think I kind of want to say it comes from campuses, you know, universities. I think that, you know, my experience on a university campus has been definitely telling. I think that, you know, instructors and professors definitely teach this stuff as if it's fact, when it really isn't. And unfortunately, on campuses, it's not really safe for people with dissenting views. So I think it comes from campuses.
So that means the government and the big foundations.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what caused it or where it came from, but I definitely know that, you know, education is being used as the foundation for it.
Well, look, it's a free world. I don't hate anybody for their identity. And I understand that folks, you know, have different views, different ideas out there. I mean, I truly, and we call classical liberal. But what about some of the people out there that claim they were confused when they were young and the state, the system came in and push them to say, no, you are another gender?
Yeah, you know, my story isn't like that. I definitely transitioned a little bit later in life. I'm 22. I started my transition around 20. And I think that it's definitely wrong for any type of institution, whether it be a teacher, whether it be the state, whether it be a doctor or a therapist, to push that on a kid. You know, transitioning is a really serious decision, and it's one that will affect the rest of your life. And it's one that has a lot of irreversible changes, sometimes dangerous changes. So I definitely disagree with that. I think that transition is a choice that you make, should be when you're an adult.
When we come back with our guest, Blair White, who is a trans person, I'm going to ask the question, getting past individuals, the government, the media pushing this, making it the central narrative, is about getting in our ideas that we can trans into anything, including with machines. And I assure you, that's the next shoe to drop. This is all about the rise of the cyborgs. Get ready. Female privilege, anti-feminism is one of the intriguing videos. And I want to get Blair White back on the next few weeks with Leanne McAdoo or myself or one of the other hosts to talk about. We've only got about 6 months left right now, where imagine you're a man when you transition to a woman, or if you disagree with that, people think you're a woman. And suddenly you're treated so much better. So there's just so many different angles that Blair White's bringing up that I never hear from the mainstream barking of just bullying. Look at me. I'm the center of the universe by the whole mainstream media system. Let's talk about that a little bit. And then also, do you agree or disagree that there seems to be a cultural obsession with this now? And that I really think it's just about getting people ready overall, not a judgment on you or anyone individually, but overall the media is pushing it to prepare us for body augmentation, merging with machines.
I have no idea about merging with machines or anything. I've never heard about that at all. But on the female privilege thing, I would say that that's one of the reasons I also started my channel. I think there's a real cultural shift happening that really demonizes straight white men, and that was one of the reasons why I wanted to speak out about this kind of thing. So, yeah.
Well, I mean, absolutely. It's like some of these folks say, you're an effing white male. You don't have any speech, but they're white males saying it. Or redheads don't have souls. That goes beyond South Park. People really make fun of redheads now. It's very mean. What do you think's going on?
I really, really don't know. I don't know if there's some, you know, grand scheme to force men into some kind of second class citizenship, but I know that it's happening, not that happening, but I know that the cultural shift is happening, and it's something that I wanted to speak out against because, you know, in my experience, I think that, you know, coming from someone who's lived life on sort of both sides of the fence, I think that there are a lot of social advantages and privileges afforded to women. And I think that the idea that men somehow hold all of the power in society is false.
What were some of your experiences? You break them down in the video, but once you've gone from a man to a woman, what were the experiences?
I think that, you know, society in general, people around you, friends, even family, they seem to put your comfortability in high regard. Everyone really looks out for you a lot more. People are definitely kinder. People, complete strangers, will go out of their way to make your day better or help you out or just hold doors. And, you know, those are trivial, but there's also larger things like getting less prison sentences, less time, and obviously lower rates of violence, homicide, and even rape when you count in prison stats. So I think there's a lot of things that people tend to overlook. And, you know, feminists seem to harp on this toxic masculinity thing, which I think is also pretty bad.
Well, it's a war within humanity, a war against our very nature to bring us down. I mean, that's what's going on. And humans are all about changing their environment. Humans are all about, you know, we wear clothing, so we lose our hair. I mean, the human experience is the fact that we are changing. And so yeah. I believe in people's individual rights to whatever they want, as long as they don't hurt someone else. But I really think that they have captured the trans movement and things like that that only started, 40 years ago, is very, very small, and now it's huge, to drive a public debate that diverts people from so many of our shared basic freedoms that are being lost.
Yeah, I think, like I said earlier in the show, I think trans people have really been co-opted by feminists and by social justice warriors. I think that there's a common misconception by people that transgenderism is an invention of third wave feminism, which is no fault of their own. You know, like I said, they've really gained a monopoly on the conversation. So anything you ever hear about trans people comes from them. And I think that it does a disservice to actual trans people because it sort of sets them up for an adversarial relationship with the world around them. I mean, the video that you showed of Milo Stewart that I was doing the response video to, you know, telling trans people that everyone around them hates them because they're trans is just, first of all, disingenuous. And second of all, like I said, I think it does a disservice to trans people.
Sure, it sets it up to make it militarized, militant, and to create balkanization.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that it also drives, you know, people that aren't trans, in other words, the overwhelming majority of people, to think that we all hold these very crazy, militant beliefs. And like I said, it's a huge disservice.
Well, I'm glad you recognize you're being used as a pawn big time. And, you know, all political groups to some extent have pawns. But I tell you, I don't know what you call the left today. I mean, they're constantly promoting pedophilia. They're attacking the family. They're attacking women that are in classical roles. It's really an anti-human group of people, in my view.
Yeah. And what's really interesting is it seems as if to me that transgender women are actually on the next chopping block to be sort of kicked out of the in-group when it comes to these people. There's been more and more people sort of expressing the view that trans women reinforce the gender binary and that we are problematic because of that. Because
well, that's right. They want to go to gender neutral. You're absolutely right. You're being completely set up. I want to get you back on. Very, very, very sophisticated, very smart. We'll be back. Stay with us. We are back live. We're going to finish out this hour with Peter Schiff of Euro Pacific Capital. Then in the fourth hour, David Nye is going to be running the show. It was, I don't know, 3-4 months ago that the Royal Bank of Scotland came out and said, sell everything paper. Run for the hills. And now we see Saudi Arabia say they're going to pay folks with IOUs and borrowing $10 billion a week. I mean, there is a lot of crazy stuff going on. And I know we're kind of the last to know here, but they're admitting the world's going into a depression. We're going to talk to Peter Schiff, who's accurately predicted it all, and that gold would go up. I don't even sell gold. I don't have even a gold sponsor. I should get one. I'm looking around right now for the very best company to do it with. I know Peter does it as well. I'll get him as a sponsor. But what I'm getting at is this. Paper is being absolutely devalued everywhere, but they say get more into paper. And all I know is you're crazy if you're not partially into something else, farmland, gold, equipment, whatever. I mean, it's just a really creepy feeling. Like every moment I'm sitting here on air, I'm not doing my family a justice. I should be getting ready. And I've never had a fire under my butt like this. I've never had such just gut-level concern because I look at hundreds of news articles a day. We're going to talk to Peter about just how bad it is, how bad it's going to get, and what some of these warning signs are here in just a moment. First off, It is so important if they have the internet kill switch or censor sites more, as you've seen with Facebook and Twitter getting in trouble doing. Lynn Beck's out defending it because he thinks he'll be protected and be the one conservative you can hear from because he's not a conservative. Whatever. We need to be able to contact you via email. And so I do want to see Hillary for prison shirts everywhere. I do want to see come and take it shirts everywhere. So we're basically selling them, and I think like a $2 profit a piece, which with advertising and everything is a lost leader. Because if I'm not plugging something that makes money, I'm plugging something that loses money. That's how that works. So I'm doing a lost leader because I want to see Hillary for prison shirts everywhere. And they're already all over the news. They're already all over Trump rallies. I mean, it's already crazy. So if 30,000 of these shirts in the last year getting out there is causing issues, and other folks are copying them, which is fine with me, imagine what 100,000 will do. Well, it'll fund our operation, but more importantly, it'll spread the word. And if I can get you to sign up for our free newsletter with exclusive videos, articles, promo codes, coupons, I mean, you really should be on the newsletter every day. I'm going to start every week offering key items for 50% off. And as we kick this off for members of Prison Planet, for members of the exclusive newsletter, Infowars.com/newsletter, put in your email, create a new email, whatever, and we will send you a promo code to get 50% off. That's 50% off right now on the Hillary for Prison shirt and or the Come and Take It Molon Labe shirt in any size you want, printed right here in America. And by the way, a lot of folks are signing up. We just put in an order to print a bunch more, but it only takes a week for it to turn around. So it looks like we already sold out of what we have. But I'm not calling it sold out because it takes a week to get more. So it'll be a couple weeks till you get them probably. But InfoWarsStore.com, you can buy them at regular price. If you want to support the broadcast, that's fine. But go to InfoWars.com/newsletter. Put in your email and get 50% off these T-shirts. $9.95 at checkout with the promo code with a 4.9-star review. You can't beat that. Also, 20% off the Good Halogen Survival Shield Nascent Iodine X2 is running at least for the weekend. And that's the good halogen that blocks the bad halogens that your thyroid has to have to operate. You die without iodine. Most iodine is toxic or bound and is unabsorbable or less absorbable. Ours is the purest out there. We're very proud of it. 20% off. We rarely discount it, but I want to get everybody who hasn't tried it to get involved today and support the broadcast. 4.8-star reviews at InfoWarsLife.com. InfoWarsStore.com is the umbrella site that has thousands of items, but InfoWarsLife.com takes you right to the nutraceuticals. We have the best vitamin mineral / amino acid fusion fruit punch. Totally organic and natural and delicious. Available at InfoWarsLife.com. That's back in stock. That's essential to get massive absorption. Most of multivitamins, you barely absorb them because the gut, look at the studies, can't absorb a lot of things like methylcobalamin, vitamin B12. Well, this way you do absorb more right through the mouth and the throat and other areas, and the saliva is able to break it down for better absorption. You need your multivitamin in a liquid form. This is the game-changing best. 2 years of research from the top labs in the country produced vitamin mineral fusion. InfoWarsLife.com. Now joining us is Peter Schiff for the balance of the hour. Europac.com. Peter Schiff has billions under management. His father recently passed. Erwin Schiff was one of the top patriots in the country, going back even predating Ron Paul. It's just good to see how it runs in the family. And he has been accurately predicting what's happening in the economy now. And he's been accurately predicting that gold would go up, which it's been doing, despite the fact they're trying to suppress it. And so I want to get from him just how dire the straits are. Why are the elites running to the Cook Islands? Why are they running to New Zealand? Why are they buying armored redoubts? Why are the Saudis paying folks in IOUs? What in Hades is going on? Peter Schiff, thanks for coming on with us.
Oh, thanks for having me on, Alex.
Where should we start?
Well, you started talking about the price of gold. You know, it actually had a little bit of a decline this week because, you know, the Federal Reserve minutes were released on Wednesday. This is for the meeting they had about 6 weeks ago.
Sure. I'm in the aggregate, though. It's big up on the year, right?
So. Oh, yeah. I mean, it's up. I mean, it started the year, you know, below 1,100. It got down to 1050. When the Fed just raised rates in December. But it's had a pretty big run. But the gold stocks have gone up a lot more. In fact, there are silver stocks that have gone up 300-400%, some 500% since their January lows. So that's been the biggest move. But the pullback started with the Fed coming out and talking about the fact that if the job market continues to improve and if the economy continues to get better, that they might raise rates in June. And of course, everybody interpreted that to mean, oh, the Fed's going to raise rates in June, when they didn't actually say that, but they talked about it.
And that's that tease you predicted five or six times that they indeed did. Then you correctly, I remember, predicted a month before they would go up a little bit. And then now you're predicting they're going to keep it the same. I mean, you've been pretty much dead on.
Yeah, you know, I don't think they're going to raise rates in June. I mean, it is possible, again, they could make that mistake, because they did make the mistake from their perspective of notching them up in December.
And you did predict, I hate to interrupt you, but it's good to be, you know, interrupted me. You did predict that the QE Unlimited would not work, and it has not worked.
No, and they're going to do it again, because they never admit their mistakes. But what's going to happen is that they're probably not going to raise, because if you actually look at what's happened in the last 6 weeks, not only has the labor market not strengthened, it's actually weakened considerably. And the economic data that's come out over the last 6 weeks on balance has been worse than expected. So, you know, if the Fed was hoping to get, you know, better news, they didn't get better news. And, you know, I think the news is actually worse than the government reports, because I don't think we're telling the whole story. The only numbers that are really coming up are the inflation numbers. And for some reason, they're saying this is a good thing. You know, the fact that inflation is picking up, you know, apparently is progress, according to the Fed. You know, the CPI we just got showed an annualized increase in consumer prices, if you multiply it out, at 6% a year. And this is supposed to be good news. It's supposed to represent progress towards price stability. No, it's not. We're going in the opposite direction. If you want prices to be stable, you don't want them to go up at all. The fact that they're going up faster doesn't mean you're getting closer to your goal of price stability. You're getting further away from your goal.
What does it signify that oil's gone up some?
Well, oil's going up because the dollar's reversed. The dollar's going down, and the dollar did, you know, move up a little bit when on the Fed announcement. But interestingly, oil didn't move down very much, and oil right now is just below $49 a barrel. And we're up over 70% from the lows. I mean, we were down below 30. We got down to like 27, 28. But yes, we're still below the $100 a barrel we were at, what, a year and a half or 2 years ago, wherever we were up there.
Sure.
But you know what? We can get up there very quickly. If the Fed doesn't hike rates in June, I think they're setting the dollar up for a big drop and another huge run up in gold and oil. And in fact, even if the Fed does raise rates, I don't think that's bearish for gold. Because what happened to gold the last time the Fed raised rates? It went way up, because these rate hikes are too little too late.
Sure, I understand. Let me ask you this question. You're dead on. I think you're probably the most accurate guy out there of everybody we interview. So let me ask you this then. Why is the media right that we're finally in big financial problems? How bad is it globally? You've got all this default stuff in places like Puerto Rico. Now they have a deal with Congress. You've got all this bail-ins more in Europe. You've got all these pension funds going belly up. You've got the Saudis can't pay their bills. I mean, what is going on?
Well, I don't think the media is coming close to acknowledging how bad the economy actually is. I mean, I think if you just look at how popular Bernie Sanders is and Donald Trump, that's a good indication of how bad the economy is, because both the left and the right know how bad it is. And so they're both grasping for straws, looking for something different. But, you know, you mentioned Puerto Rico. And the interesting thing about Puerto Rico is Puerto Rico is broke. I mean, that's pretty obvious. Even the governor admits that mathematically, you know, they can't pay their debts. But 3 years ago, they were just as broke. It's just that nobody cared, because creditors weren't worried. They just kept lending the money, even though they were broke and interest rates were down.
So it's a cold sore. It's a canary in the coal mine. The fact that that's happening shows other big creditors are now overextended.
Well, it just shows you that, you know, it's all a question of, it's never a problem until it is, right? So Puerto Rico was broke, but now it's a problem because the creditors figured out that they're broke. Well, America is more broke than Puerto Rico.
Sure.
That's a fact. It's just that our creditors haven't figured it out yet. But when they do, then Donald Trump is going to end up being right, because all we can do is default. And if we don't default, if we print money, which now Trump is saying, oh, we don't have to default because we could print. Well, printing is worse than default, because printing doesn't just wipe out the bondholders. It wipes out anybody who owns U.S. dollars.
Yeah, I agree with you. Trump is wrong on that front. I like him because he's sincere. You were Ron Paul's chief economic advisor, and you advised others in Congress and testified, obviously, Peter Schiff. What would you advise Trump to do? I mean, I know the advice on the show actually gets to him. I know he, you know, tunes into what we have to say and our guests have to say pretty much on a daily basis. What would you say to Trump?
Well, you know, it's hard to say what's the best thing for Trump, the candidate, to say. I mean, so far, he's done a pretty good job as Trump, the candidate. But if he actually wins, you know, the advice that I would give Trump, the president, is actually when he talked about some kind of restructure, that is exactly what we need, because we can't pay back our debt, but we need higher interest rates. Now, Donald Trump said, hey, I'm a low interest rate guy. Low interest rates are part of the problem. Now, Donald Trump knows that if interest rates go up, we can't afford to pay our debt. So his solution is to keep interest rates low. But that doesn't work. That's part of the problem. That's why the economy can't have real economic growth.
Sure, we'll end up like Japan if this continues.
Yeah, we need higher interest rates, but then we have to admit that we have too much debt to afford higher interest rates, and we have to restructure. That is the painful reality that we have to
sure.
do.
Sure, because if we don't restructure, we'll just finally either collapse or just go into stagnation. I mean, which one is it?
Well, it'll be a massive inflation, because if we keep interest rates low forever, no matter how high inflation gets, then the dollar collapses and they keep printing and printing and printing. And then that type of scenario, runaway inflation, hyperinflation, that is much worse than a legitimate restructuring.
Sure. Yeah, well, I'm no rocket scientist like you when it comes to mathematics and economy, but it seems to me if they're creating tens of trillions more in derivatives and fake dollars and credit default swaps and all this crap, that it's going to cause inflation. So where are they hiding all the inflation? Because to me, it seems like it should be much worse by now.
You know, it's actually hiding in plain sight, because first of all, the inflation is all the money printing, right? That's the definition. The consequence of inflation is that prices go up. But look, stock prices went way up. Real estate prices went back up.
Sure.
Yeah, look, rare art went back up. You know, collectible cars went back up. I mean, asset prices have gone up like crazy. That is inflation. And of course, anybody who lives in America knows that the prices are going up. Look, rents are up about 8% year over year. Look at how much healthcare costs have gone up. Utilities are going up. Look at the price of food. Have you bought a steak recently at a supermarket? I mean, prices are going up. It's just that the government is not doing an accurate job of reporting, and that is by design.
So they're messing with the numbers. Oh, I agree. I've been going to the same steakhouse for like 15 years, and 15 years ago, the steak was $25. I thought that was too much. The same steak I want is $100, and I won't get it just because it costs $100. A good ribeye, now at the store, it's like $25. At a steakhouse, it's $100. I mean, that same ribeye at the grocery store was like $8 5 years ago. So you're right. Oh, yeah. There's huge inflations.
Yeah, I mean, try to barbecue for your family. How many people can still afford to put steaks on that barbecue? I mean, a lot of people can barely afford
it. We have hamburgers. I mean, I got a little bit of money just to run the operation, but still, I'm not going to buy steak at that price.
Yeah, I mean, look, the standard of living is going down. I mean, Americans are working two or three jobs apiece, and they can barely make ends meet. You know, this economy is a disaster, and everyone wants to pretend that it's great, because no one wants to admit that Obama is a complete failure, that the Federal Reserve was a complete failure, that everything the government has done has failed.
So what happens next? You've accurately told us, I'd say about 95% accuracy, what's going to happen. What happens next, Peter Schiff?
Well, it depends on what your time frame is. But, you know, I do think that we are either back in recession or so close to one that we will be in one shortly. And I think it's more likely that we're already there. But the question is, will the Fed reverse course and cut rates before or after the election? That's a little bit of a wild card. I think if it wasn't an election, they would just go ahead and do it. But I think, you know, the Fed wants to artificially stimulate the economy to help Hillary Clinton win. But they don't want to have to admit that the economy needs stimulus, because that would undercut her message of trying to continue the successful policies of Obama. Because if we're back in recession while he's still president, that proves that his policies were a failure. So the Fed is caught in a difficult position, and I'm not exactly sure, you know, which poison they're going to choose, but they have to decide. But to just keep pretending that everything is great and then maybe even raising interest rates, that is probably going to help Donald Trump.
What would you do? Sure. What would you do then?
What would I do? I mean, we wouldn't be in this predicament if I was there. But if you put me in today, you know, I'd be like one of the CEOs. You know, you get, when you come in, you know, you want a clean house, right? You want to get all the bad news out. You want to throw everything out, including the kitchen sink. Get it all out of the way. You know, sometimes they just want to blame the predecessor. But in this case, it would be the fault of my predecessors. If I was the head of the Federal Reserve.
No, I understand. So if you were the head of the Fed or the head of the Treasury or co-head of both, what would you do? Boom.
Yeah. Well, I would admit that everything that was done by my predecessors going back, not Volcker, but Greenspan and Bernanke and Yellen, that everything they did was wrong. Right. I said, look, we got to raise interest rates. And I'm trying to let the market set interest rates, but I tell the markets the Fed is not going to be in there. We're not going to be intervening.
Which starts encouraging investment again, not just free money.
But we're not going to keep interest rates down. We're going to let the market push them however high they have to go. And I think they'd go pretty high. And I tell the Congress, we're not buying any of your paper. So you better balance this budget right now or interest rates are going sky high. And if you can't handle the interest rates, then you better go.
So you'd encourage a real market again.
Oh, yeah. I would tell the government there's no more easy way out. You level with the voters. Either you cut government spending. You know, if you want to raise taxes, you can try that, but I don't think that'll work. So you cut government spending. You negotiate with your creditors. But the gravy train is over. There's no more debt monetization. You're going to have to deal with the consequences of your profligacy. And as a Fed chairman, I'm not going to enable it anymore. I would be an independent central bank, which is exactly what we need.
All right, Peter Schiff is our guest. I said we have one run by foreign interest and the government and all these other crazies that keep wanting to kick the can down the road, which only makes the implosion that much bigger. Well, look, I'll tell you something right now, and folks know I just go with my gut. I've never been more concerned about what's happening politically. And just the hatred the elite have for the people and their arrogance. But then the general public has a lot of hardworking people of every race, color, and creed and religion, but there's also all these entitled social justice warriors and lazy people everywhere. If we have a depression, I don't know where this is going to go. And then I look at the triggers. There's so many triggers. What keeps you up at night, Peter Schiff of Euro-Pacific Capital, Europac.com? What keeps you up at night? The next trigger, the public's response, 51% of people under 30 in polls want Bernie. Let's admit it. I mean, the West is declining. We had it so good with the free market. We got spoiled and fat, and our kids got even more spoiled and fat. I mean, is that an accurate statement, or you disagree? I'm horrified.
It's been a long time since we've had a free market. Most people alive today don't even remember one. But, you know, we have the remnants of the free market. We've been surviving on that, you know, but it gets less and less free. But, you know, I don't know what keeps me up at night. You know, I have a 4-week-old baby daughter now, but she doesn't actually keep me up that much. But
congratulations.
You know, thank you. But yeah, you know, none of this stuff, I sleep soundly in that respect. I mean, I know it's bad and I know it's going to get a lot worse, but I'm hopeful that at the end of the day, the American people can do the right thing when push comes to shove. And, you know, you see all these polls and people, you know, how popular socialism is, you know, how many Americans believe in socialism. And of course, you know, this is a real indoctrination of the government school system, which has so poorly educated our kids for a tremendous amount of money. But I think if Americans were explained in the right way, the real difference between freedom and socialism and why what we've had is closer to socialism than freedom and how the solution really, really lies in individual liberty and the free market. And there's nothing the government can do because it'll be obvious when this thing falls apart. It'll have to be obvious to everybody, even the left, that the government is responsible because we have so many government programs and so many people from the government who have made all kinds of empty promises that are going to turn out to be completely false. So hopefully the American public can get back to our roots because if we can embrace those free market principles, there's no limit to what we can accomplish.
That's what produced all the choices. It's a no-brainer, and you're right. For probably 70 years, we haven't had much of a free market. We never had a total free market. But as we get more and more towards command and control, we see the prosperity dissipate. So you're right. The answer is expose the fact that this system is crony capitalism at the top, socialism at the bottom. I mean, look at Venezuela right now, a total hellhole.
Look, they are feeling the burn big time over there in Venezuela. And I know the people that, you know, that talk about democratic socialism and you bring up Venezuela like this. Well, we didn't mean that kind. We mean like the Swedish kind. Look, you know, the reason that Sweden is still wealthy is because before Sweden adopted those socialist type programs, they were a very wealthy economy. They didn't have these programs until they were rich. And then because they implemented these programs, they're less rich. And now they're trying to dial it back. But, you know, these countries that really have had it where, you know, you got free health care in Venezuela, you got free education, free college, you know, just like Bernie Sanders won. Everything is free, except there's nothing available, right? You can get anything you want for free, except you can't get anything.
Right. Doctors are free, but you can't get in to see one to get aspirin. And you're right. Sweden, under free market, built an incredible infrastructure. And now, like dumb heathens, people are living in the infrastructure built by the last generations, even though that's starting to crumble now.
Yeah, well, and the Swedes already recognize the mistakes of the welfare state and how it has corrupted younger Swedes and how they live in these social safety nets. And so there is a big movement to try to move in the other direction. But you can't be socialist unless you first become rich through capitalism. Then you can squander your wealth. But the countries that are poor have gone from one dictator to another, and they've never had freedom.
Rich countries slit their wrists with the socialist razor blade later. Peter Schiff, you're absolutely right, but you've got to be capitalist to be able to put on the dog and pony show of socialism. Europac.com. Have a great weekend. Thank you so much, sir, for your insight.
We talked about gold. Shift gold. Get your gold.
Absolutely. Absolutely. People should do that. We'll be back with the fourth hour, Infowars.com/show, and 50% off right now when you sign up for the newsletter on the t-shirts. I'll be honest with you. This is an epic battle. I am so excited to be alive right now. I am so excited to be involved right now and informed. I am honored to be here with you on this Friday worldwide broadcast. I am honored to be about to hand the baton to David Knight for the next 55 minutes once he takes over. I am honored to have this great crew behind us. And I'm even more honored to have you as listeners and viewers. Just know this. I know I'm only human. I know I fall down. I know I have problems. But I'm doing the best I can. I know you are too. Good people are so humble. But we've got to realize that we've got the light in the world. We've got to take action. You know, we have all these amazing special forces guys on that, you know, can like go 50 miles with a 70-pound pack on their back and fight a battle once they get there and control themselves when people are shot and dying around them and you know, control their breath when they've just been running 10 miles and, you know, sit there and have a firefight and control themselves icy cold. And then come back and blow the whistle on Benghazi and things like that. It's amazing. And then when you interview these people in person or in private or on air, they're like neurotically humble. And I'm always thinking, why is that? And then evil people, weak people, are so arrogant. But I don't want folks to ever think my aggression and my confidence and my anger is arrogance. It's the opposite. It is like struggling when you are down at 100 feet and your mask gets water in it. This hasn't happened to me, but I've read about it and seen it happen. And you're panicking to the surface. I'm just someone whose instincts and very humanity is in a death struggle. I'm under attack. I know. I'm under attack. And I'm not saying I'm under attack to say, oh, I'm a victim, poor me. I'm saying I'm under attack. I'm fighting for my life. And I know I'm fighting for my life. And you know a little secret about it? Our species has been fighting for its life ever since we arrived on this planet. And I did say arrived, didn't I? We were put here by the Creator. You know, how is that a kooky thing to say when the Bible says it that billions of people supposedly believe? But when I say we were put here by the Creator, people say, oh, Jones says we're seated by aliens. I just said what I said. We were put here. And since we arrived here, we have been put through an incredible test. And we're now going to face the computers. We're going to face the AI. We're going to face the eugenics. We're going to face our own species mutated and merged with evil and influenced by fallen off-world technology. And we're about to go through the metamorphosis of the test that takes us to the next level. It isn't the devil playing God with all his mutations and all his corruptions that is the great test that's going to create the Superman, the Ubermenschen. It is the devil as a tester of gods that is going to bring humanity to the next level. And that's God's plan of free will. Don't fail this test. Don't be a fool. And don't sell out to death. Don't sell out to hating your fellow humans. Don't sell out to going, people are stupid. Let's feed on them. Man, folks are dumb. No, build them up. And that's all Christ asks. And then you're going to get that slot to the next level. And that isn't out of some book. That's in my gut. I know it. I can tell. My soul's old. So's yours. I could feel it. I could see it. I know. Not of this world, my friends. Think about that. And the enemy knows that. We'll be back. Stay with us. David Knight coming in. Infowars.com.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight on this Friday, May 20th, 2016, our fourth hour of Overdrive. We've got an interesting hour coming up. We're going to be talking to someone who was born in China as the Cultural Revolution of Mao began shortly after her birth. She lived under that. We're going to talk to her about that. But now she is in America. She's an American citizen. She escaped that slavery. She said, I was a slave before. I will never be one again. Her name is Lily Tang Williams. She's running for U.S. Senate in Colorado. So we're going to talk to her about her life story. We're going to talk to her about what she wants to do to stop America from becoming what the globalists created in China and in Russia. That is communism. And you know, of course, that it was the globalists who sent Lenin on a train with $10 million in gold. It was the German central bankers who sent him from Switzerland into Russia to start the Russian Revolution. And, of course, we just had Henry Kissinger meet with Donald Trump. And it was kind of interesting because Donald Trump made a quick reference to it. He said, yeah, I met with this guy. He told me that the Chinese are really not very happy with what I'm saying about trade. I thought it was interesting. He's kind of signaling us that, yeah, Henry Kissinger came to him as an emissary of the globalist Chinese kleptocrats that he and Richard Nixon helped to put into place. And now they're saying, you know what, we don't want you overturning this apple cart of globalism that we have set up here. It's not about free trade, folks. This is about trading away our base. I watched the Libertarian Party debate last night because there's been 2 one-hour debates with three of the candidates. We had Gary Johnson, who's running a second time. We had McAfee, who we've interviewed multiple times here on the Alex Jones Show. We've interviewed Gary Johnson when he was running 4 years ago as well. And also a new guy, Austin Peterson. They were being interviewed by Stossel on Fox News. And I watched the second hour of that as they started talking beyond just the general principles of individual liberty that the Libertarian Party stands for. We started talking about individual policy aspects. Very disturbing to see where they were on some of these issues. But I want to talk to Lily Tang about where she is on some of these issues. And as the reason I watched it yesterday was because we just got word that Gary Johnson, as I pointed out, is running for a second time. This is only the second time that someone has sought the Libertarian nomination, a repeat of it. It was done with Harry Brown, who ran twice. Prior to that, the Libertarian Party never had anyone run two times for president. They ran once and then stepped down. And there was a lot of concern when that happened with Harry Brown. But Harry was a very articulate spokesman. He was thoroughly acquainted with libertarian philosophy. He was not somebody who was trying to create a political career. And an exception was made for Harry Brown, and I agreed with that. I was working with the LP as a delegate, and I voted for Harry Brown at the time. I'm concerned when we see politicians who are now moving together, not because it's a never-Trump movement. I don't really think that's even going to happen. I don't think the Republicans are going to line up behind the Libertarians. I don't think they're going to try to take over the Libertarian Party. There was a report that the Koch brothers are talking about giving money to Gary Johnson. This came out yesterday from the Daily Mail. And he said, no, I haven't heard anything about that. They may do that, but I haven't seen any evidence that they'll do that. I don't think that'll happen. I'm just concerned when I see people who have been, and again, if he runs with William Weld, who is a former governor of Massachusetts, which is what he's now saying, William Weld was a two-term governor from Massachusetts, a heavily Democrat state, obviously. Gary Johnson was a two-term governor from Arizona, New Mexico, also a very heavy Democrat state. And basically, they governed as Democrats. They ran as Republicans, but they governed as Democrats. And when I look at the platform that Gary Johnson had 4 years ago, it really focused more on gay marriage than it did on the NSA. And I thought it was a real misdirection of the Libertarian Party. If you want to run as a Democrat, run as a Democrat. But I was very concerned about where they were and the fact that they really haven't kept up with the threats to individual liberty. That's why I welcomed McAfee running as a candidate for the Libertarian Party. I think he brings, and could bring, an awareness to a lot of vital issues that are before us right now that need to be addressed. We keep seeing the federal government saying because the technology is different, we don't have to worry about the Fourth Amendment. They were just talking about paper and pen. We're talking about your electronic records. So because these records are electronic, the Fourth Amendment doesn't apply when it says we need to get a search warrant. We see that over and over again. And so that issue needs to be addressed. I don't believe libertarians are stepping up to the plate to do that. I'm ashamed to say. And I was very concerned about what they had to say about open borders and about trade. I thought it was incredibly naive and abstract and out of touch with not only the history of what has happened, but what is going on at the very moment. It's like this. We were having this conversation 10 or 20 years ago, talking about, well, what might happen if we brought people in? We had as part of the debate, Stossel brought up to them, well, if you're going to have open borders, how do you do that with a welfare state? Milton Friedman said, you can't have open borders in a welfare state. It'll bankrupt the country. And, you know, I took the Nolan chart, which is a way that they get people to understand that it isn't simply a two-dimensional left-right paradigm. If we map out the political spectrum, it really turns into a kind of at least a two-dimensional map. I thought that was something that one of the founders of the Libertarian Party, David Nolan, did that really helped people to understand the political spectrum and policies. And maybe we'll talk about that with Lily Tang. But the bottom line is they'll ask you 10 questions on personal liberty. They'll ask you 10 questions on economic freedom. And based on how you answer those questions, they map you out on what is a diamond. They rotate that axis by 45 degrees. And so it makes a diamond with a left and a right on it. And the one question that I didn't answer from a libertarian perspective 25 years ago was the open border issue. And I said the same thing. I didn't know that Milton Friedman had said that you can't have open borders if you have welfare state at the same time that'll bankrupt the country. But that's what I said. I mean, it's intuitively obvious. I didn't know anything about Cloward and Piven at that point either. But when that was brought up, one of the candidates there, Austin Peterson, said, well, what Milton Friedman was really saying was, and I've got the quote here, he said, actually, it's better if you have illegal immigration. Illegal immigration is superior because they don't qualify for benefits. And this is what Milton Friedman said. He said, well, you got Mexican immigration coming over the border. It's a good thing. It's a good thing for the illegal immigrants. It's a good thing for the United States. It's a good thing for the citizens of the country. But it's only as good as long as it's illegal, because the illegals don't get benefits. It's like, okay, if we want to talk about this in your ivory tower, we could talk about that. We could say that maybe 20, 30 years ago when Milton Friedman said that, we could theorize that was the way it was going to work. In reality, that's not the way it's working. In reality, what's happening is illegal immigrants are coming into this country and they're getting greater welfare benefits than our Social Security retirees. They're getting greater educational benefits than our college students whose parents paid taxes in a state so they could get an in-state tuition reduction. The illegal immigrants get that everywhere. So over and over again, we're saying, yes, in fact, they are getting superior benefits. They're not only getting benefits, but they're getting superior benefits. So I don't really understand where we are when we've got a Libertarian Party that is arguing things in the abstract after we see what has already been happening for the last 9 years or so. Okay, and even longer than that, we've seen what's been happening with the open borders, and we've seen the consequences of this for a very long time, going back to the first amnesty from Ronald Reagan. Ronald Reagan gave immigration amnesty. It didn't work then. It won't work now. It's not working. And so we have to look and address the problems as they are instead of as we would like to see them. Nevertheless, I want to talk to Lily. She's got some great ideas. She has fought Common Core. I agree with her on many, many issues. She is a hardcore gun advocate. No, by the way, Donald Trump was endorsed by the NRA. Why wouldn't they endorse him at this point? Are they going to endorse Hillary Clinton or Bernie Sanders? I mean, Bernie Sanders has gotten like a D or D minus whenever they have analyzed his voting record. Hillary Clinton gets an F minus only because you can't go any lower than that on the Second Amendment, on our right to protect ourselves. And of course, Lily Tang, who lived in China, understands the importance of being able to protect yourself from the government, not just private thugs who are operating in our real world that we live in, but from the government. That's what the design of the Second Amendment was about with the founders. They were very concerned about the consolidation of power. And of course, that's why we're concerned about globalism versus nationalism. If we don't preserve our country, if we don't preserve the sovereignty of America, we won't have a Bill of Rights, we won't have a Constitution, we won't have any framework that we can even make a case to protect individual liberty. That will all be gone. So we have to, and it's not a kind of fascist nationalism to say we need to retain the United States of America. That's the way the globalists are trying to portray this. We need not let them shame us into doing that, because you can look at what they're doing. This is an article that was on Infowars.com yesterday by Don Salazar. It got a Drudge link. Google honors a Maoist who admired Osama bin Laden. And there's a quote from her. I thank Islam for bin Laden. This is an Asian American revolutionary, Yuri Kochiyama, who admired Karl Marx, Mao Zedong, Osama bin Laden, to name a few of the people that are there that she loves and admires. And so, of course, that would be the person that Google would admire. You know, Google has literally come unglued. Literally come unglued. This is another story that was up on Infowars.com, and I laughed out loud when I saw it. Google's sticky car patent glues pedestrians in place after an accident. That's right. You hit somebody with your self-driving car, which I thought that was never going to happen. You're never going to hit anybody with these self-driving cars. They're going to eliminate human fatalities. But, you know, it's much better to hit this person and have them stuck to the car like flypaper than it is to hit them and then have them bounce off. We'll be right back and explain that logic more in depth. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host. And as I point out, we're going to be talking to someone who grew up in China, managed to find her way to freedom, and hates to see what is happening to our country. So much so that she is running for U.S. Senate to try to stop the slide into us becoming the kind of totalitarian government that she grew up in. So we're going to talk to her about that, talk to her about her Senate campaign in Colorado. Before we do, real quickly, I want to play this clip for you from Leanne McAdoo talking about our Handcuff Hillary contest. Here's that clip.
Great job, guys. The Handcuff Hillary hashtag has gone completely viral, and for good reason. People intuitively know that Hillary Clinton belongs in prison for her criminal activities, not as the president. The truth has come out about Benghazi, her private email server, and even her Wall Street connections. She's totally establishment and as criminal as they come. And now people can even see that the DNC has rigged the system in her favor against Bernie Sanders. And you know what? His supporters are getting pissed. Do you really want to make everyone angry there at the DNC when you show up to the convention in this t-shirt? Well, now we're going to make it super easy for all of you out there to do that. It's time to take a stand against Hillary and all of her criminal actions and support the info war. You can get the Hillary for Prison t-shirt. You've seen it all over the news. It's really making waves out there. Get this t-shirt right now for half off when you sign up for the InfoWars newsletter. That's right, we're going to give this promo code only to our InfoWars newsletter subscribers. You can get this t-shirt for half off. Go to InfoWars.com/newsletter, and for a limited time, you can receive this t-shirt for 50% off the purchase price. I know that's absolutely crazy, but you're helping the InfoWar, so sign up for the newsletter today and get yours before we sell out.
All right. Thank you, Leanne. And of course, that's 50% off of t-shirts when you sign up for our free newsletter. Get your Hillary for Prison t-shirt and wear it. It will help you to identify friends and enemies, among other things. It'll also be a real conversation starter and spread the news. It's going to be either the White House or the Big House for Hillary Clinton, no doubt about it. And it's a life and death struggle, I think, between her and Donald Trump. He's going to need to win the presidency because she's going to come after him if she wins. But he has legitimate reason to put her in jail. We've talked about that multiple times. She'll just invent a reason to come after Donald Trump. Before we went to break, I was talking about this latest Google patent story that came out. This is a Google sticky car. It's a patent that glues pedestrians to the hood after you hit them with your self-driving car. And isn't that great? And that would be a sister patent to the one that Google was working on to predict driver behavior. You know, those unpredictable humans, you really can't ever tell what they're going to do. But sometimes you can predict what they're going to do by looking at their brake lights or their turn signals. And so they had a patent that would do that for the self-driving car. You would think that they would do that before they ever put these stupid things on the road in the first place. But understand, just as I began by talking about Google having this this thing that they put up at the top of their search engine honoring this Maoist who admired not only Marx and Mao, but Osama bin Laden. Okay, these are the people who want to run your transportation system. Do you want your transportation system being run by mega multinational corporations connected to our government, working with the government hand in glove to set up a kind of control grid over your movements? Is that what you really want? Do you want that kind of crony capitalism in the hands of people who admire Marxists, Maoists? That's what Google is. And of course, Google has worked with Ford and Volvo, Uber and Lyft to push a lobbying effort worldwide. This is a globalist lobbying effort. We can see the fruits of it in the UK, for example. The Queen had a speech this week to introduce legislation that will allow vehicles on the road under ordinary insurance policies. They're going to make exceptions for the insurance policies for these self-driving cars. And yet they're going to use insurance to drive you out of your car. You need to understand, they're not going to allow you to be able to afford to own and operate your own car. It's only going to be a handful of multinational corporations like Uber and Lyft and Google and Ford and Volvo. Of course, GM is getting in this with Lyft as well. But you can see what's happening. You can see the handwriting on the wall right now. This is not even something that's going to be happening in 4 years, as they say. Right now in Greenwich, just outside of London, you can sign up to take a driverless car for a spin around the little area there. And it's not going to be much of a spin. They go incredibly slowly. And as we look at the tests from Uber that they're starting in Pittsburgh, this is going to be done outside in the area where they have set up Uber's Advanced Technology Center. This is in Pittsburgh. They went in and they poached most of the robotics scientists out of Carnegie Mellon University. They set this thing up and they're telling us 94% of the car accidents that kill 1.3 million people, that's going to go away. But, well, if that's the case, then why do we need to worry about flypaper on the hood of the Google cars if they're not going to be hitting anybody? This is something we need to be very much aware of. It is coming at us faster than you think. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and joining me now is Lily Tang Williams. She is a Chinese immigrant who grew up under Mao's Cultural Revolution. Now she is running for U.S. Senate. You know, I think it's very important for us to understand that this election is about far more than the race for president. No matter who gets elected, we're not going to get our freedom back if we don't have a widespread movement. And I've said many times, I think that we overlook, we can't cover all of the local elections here at InfoWars. We pull people up from state elections, like we're talking to Lily Tang. Occasionally, we'll even talk to people who are running for state council or for city council at the very local level, not just at the state level. So I think it's very important that people understand that it's difficult to get information about who these candidates are at the local level. It's a little bit easier once we get up to people who are running for federal office like U.S. Senate. But it's very important that you do the homework to find out what these people are going to do and get behind somebody who will really make a difference. And of course, that could be your local sheriff, standing in the gap, standing against the tyranny of the federal government. But I think it's also important to take the fight to Washington. It's important to cut Washington off when they do the wrong thing, but it's also important to send good people to Washington who will fight for liberty. And that's the key point here. Not necessarily setting up security or safety or prosperity as the key thing, but liberty as the key thing. So I've said many times before, if you give up your freedom, to the degree that you give up your freedom, you become a slave. Slaves are never prosperous. Slaves are never safe. So there is no trade-off between liberty and prosperity. There's no trade-off between liberty and safety. You need to put liberty first. That's what our founders understood. Those were the principles that our country was founded upon. And now in this election, I think people are beginning to wake up to understand that if they don't do something in this election, we're not even going to have a sovereign country anymore. We're going to be ruled by foreign globalists. Now, real quickly, before I go to Lily Tang, I want to let you know that we have a sale that has just started on Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine. That's at InfoWarsLife.com. I'm not sure how much longer the sale is going to last. It's a new sale. It's 20% off of InfoWars nascent iodine. This is something that is very important to prepare for you and for your family. It's something that you need on a regular basis as a supplement for your health, but it's also something that you need to have there if you get into an emergency situation, just as you would store food or water, or you would have heirloom seeds. You can also prepare with nascent iodine. Again, it's 99.99% pure iodine salt crystals that come from deep within the earth, lab tested for purity. You can get it right now, 20% off. That's our sale that we're running at InfoWars.com. Let's go to Lily Tang joining us now. Welcome, Lily.
Hi, David. Thank you for having me.
I'm very excited to talk to you, especially because I've been to China and I've seen how people even, well, I was there 10 years ago. I'm sure it probably hasn't changed now, but I saw 10 years ago how people there still idealized Mao. And I was absolutely amazed by that because I've seen what the effects are, but not like you have. You grew up under this. Tell us a little bit about this. On your website, you say, I was a slave before, I will never be one again. Tell us a little bit about your life growing up under Mao. I want to also talk about your policies because Leanne McAdoo will have you tonight talking about the Cultural Revolution and the details of that. But I'd like for you to give us a quick overview of what it was like to grow up under Mao.
Well, I was born 2 years before Mao's Cultural Revolution in Sichuan Province, southwest of China, Mountain State. Of course, I went through entire 10 years, you know, hunger, poverty, and socio-economical chaos during that time. And I was so indoctrinated as a student in government schools, I even did not know I was a slave. I just woke up about 20, you know, like years later in this country to realize I was a slave. My government lied to me the entire time, but I just did not know it. You know, to give you the condition, what we live under, so-called free government housing, because my parents worked for state factory 6 days a week, but could not keep us fed. We live on food ration coupons. I had to get up as oldest child in the family in the winter morning to line up in long line to get wheat flour, you know, a bag of potatoes. Otherwise, they'll be sold out. And where we live is like eight families share a commune, a courtyard with one bathroom, no indoor plumbing. And so that, you know, one for male, one for females. And when also it's dinner time, you line up to get the water from one faucet. And there was always a long line. And then I had to cook for my family because I was oldest child. I was 6 years old. I had to stay home, babysit my youngest brother because, you know, my parents worked for state factories but could not afford, you know, childcare. It was not really free childcare. We had to pay for it. We had to pay for everything. So they keep me at home when I was six to babysit my one-year-old baby brother. And I was put back from school for 1 year. I was so upset. And so they got me a ticket to watch Romania fighting Nazis as my reward.
What woke you up to the fact that you were a slave? You said you didn't know that you were a slave, but what woke you up to that?
When I gave up on China, came over to this country 28 years ago, I was about 24 years old. I was fighting against my Chinese communist bosses in law school when I was a faculty in Shanghai the whole time alone because people were pretty much indoctrinated. And so I feel like I was very alone fighting them. But I still believe in government. That's the only thing I was told in my entire life. If you give me a political quiz, 28 years ago when I first came here, I would be statist. So I came here with $100 in my pocket borrowed without English speaking skill and $1,200 in debt owed to my American professor so I could go to graduate school. And I just had a big dream. This is a free country and government is going to leave me alone. I have constitutional guaranteed rights and I'll be fine. So I just started to, you know, raise family and start business, got my degree. But I was statist. I did not know other answers to our problems. My husband is a libertarian, so he slowly educated me about, you know, what kind of solutions we could have besides government. So I read some books and I did a research on all the lies that the Chinese communist government lied to us because I did not know we had no freedom of speech and freedom of press. They told us the 50 million people died of starvation was caused by 3 years natural disasters. So I did not know that until I come to this country It's because Mao's central planning policies causes people to die. So when I totally woke up, it was 2008, and I become libertarian, and I truly become big believer of libertarianism, where I have rights and freedom to pursue my life any way I see fit, without government interference, and they should not stop me from doing things I like, even though they might not like it. So I become big believer 2008.
That's great. You know, I like to see people who have, we've talked to people who grew up in Eastern Europe under communism there behind the Iron Curtain. And of course, people like you who grew up under Mao and under communism, people who have felt the chains of slavery, or even somebody like John McAfee, who's felt the bite of tyranny. I think it's very important. People who have been there, who have done that, who have lived under it, they have a passion for freedom that you just don't find in people who have been free all their life. And that's what we're missing in this country. Too many of us have grown up for generations in a free country and don't appreciate that anymore, and even beg for somebody to control our lives, to make us safe, to make us happy, to protect us. And we feel like we're going to be able to get that if we somehow trade in our freedoms. How do you address that to people? Is that what you see in America? I mean, that's what I see amongst my American friends, is that they're just so willing to give up their freedom. They treat it so cheaply because they've never truly been deprived of it. They don't understand. They don't understand that it is leaving them very quickly.
Because they were indoctrinated by the government.
Yes.
I see that our public schools are failing to educate our kids to really have passion for freedom, limited government. And that's governmental school indoctrination I experienced during Cultural Revolution. I did not know I was slave because everything government told me to say that's good for you. It's good for public goods. And, you know, to share about, you know, the privacy, for example, our home was wide open. The communist bloc committee members can walk in. Our teachers, principal coming to home visit to make sure everybody is on the same page, to be loyal to Chairman Mao, to the party. I never heard of concept of privacy until I came to this country, because that's just part of where our life is. They track us from birth to death, and then they tell you it's good for you. They were telling us we should be grateful for the party, for Chairman Mao. They saved us because 2/3 of the world population was starving. We had 100% tyranny, but we were told to believe that's good for us. It's sad to say my friends in China today never had this kind of awakening like me. They still tell me today, Lily, our life under Chairman Mao is not too bad.
Yeah.
I was speechless. You know, I'm going to teach them when they come to this country.
Well, you know, it's interesting. 10 years ago when I was there, it was to adopt my daughter. And she was staying with a foster home. She was outside of the orphanage at the time and staying with a foster home. And the family that she was living with gave her a note and said, obey your government. Do everything they tell you to do. We got that translated, and I said, oh, they gave her to the wrong family, if that's what they want her to do. But that is the mindset that permeates China to this day. And as you pointed out, they do that through education. We've seen that. We understand that that was the design of Plato and the Republic. He said, if we're going to have a strong state, we need to get the kids away from their families. They don't need to know. We need to make sure that they don't even know who their parents are, that the only loyalty that they have, the only family that they know, is the state. And that's what we see with the communists as well. And that's what I believe is behind our own cultural revolution and things like Common Core. Now, I've seen your videos, and if people go to your website, it's tell us your website.
My website is lilyforliberty.com. L-I-L-Y is number 4, lilyforliberty.com. I wanted to use this name brand for my Facebook, Twitter, and website to build my political activism. Regardless of the election outcome, I'm going to be committed to liberty movement in this country for the rest of my life, because I have really realized that this country is going down wrong path. We are losing our freedom rights every day, and people still... lots of people don't get involved or don't know about it. And that's why I'm running for U.S. Senate, because I'm reminding people, I hate to see this country I love becoming more like the country I left. And I have passion for freedom, for limited government. I came here for my American dream, but I'm worried about my children will not have the same dream that I had and to achieve them. I'm really concerned, and that's why I'm doing this full time.
I agree. Now, I've seen at your website, I've seen the videos where you're speaking out against civil asset forfeiture, against Common Core, other issues like that. Tell us what you would do if you were elected to Senate. What would you do to reform? What would be your first priority?
Well, I will hold my one of the 100 senators' votes dearly. I will explain my votes to the people. I will be the guardian for our freedom and our rights in the U.S. Senate. And I tell people that some people get elected and say whatever to go there, then they sell us out. What I will do, because exactly I despise those kind of politicians. If I go there as a first constitutional libertarian, I'm going to shake up the status quo. I'm going to expose the corruption. I'm going to expose the crony capitalism. I may not get important committee positions, but I sure will tell people what's going on in Washington and just explain my every vote. I will always vote for more freedom and less limited government. And if that's the way it is, people say, oh, you're not going to get any powerful positions there. That's fine. I'm going to let my voters decide if I'm doing a good job for their freedom, their rights or not.
Well, I've seen, and we've all seen many times, how just one person in the Senate can make a huge difference. We had Ron Wyden, with whom I have very little agreement on most of the issues, but he stood up and exposed the lies of James Clapper and the NSA. He put him in a position, asked him a question, and you saw James Clapper lie about surveillance, and then right after that, the Snowden leaks came out. So it's very important for us to have somebody with integrity, somebody with the right values in the Senate to see what's going on, to be a whistleblower. Tell us, though, something like Common Core, for example. We know how that is being used to manipulate, to engineer our society, to engineer our children, to dumb them down deliberately. We've had books written about that. Charlotte Isaby, Phyllis Schlafly wrote a book at the beginning of the Reagan administration, talked about the deliberate dumbing down of America. Now, this is it. In spades, Common Core. But they not only do they make sure that Johnny can't read or write, they also make sure that he is filled with their social agenda. That's where the social justice warriors come from, that sort of thing. What would you do to stop that?
The roots of the problem is not just Common Core, whatever other name they use, No Child Left Behind. The roots yes. of the problem is, we let the federal government taking over education, taking over our classrooms, our parental rights, our choices. I would like to sponsor, if I could, a first bill just to defund the Department of Education. Reagan tried that, did not make successful. And that's my top issue. The education is dear to my heart, top issue. To get rid of federal government interference in our education, get rid of indoctrination, get rid of data mining of our children, is to defund Department of Education. And for every 11 cents they give to us at local level, state level, we have to spend 50 cents to comply with their mandate. So you cannot really trust and take so-called evil's money. It comes with all the strings attached.
Oh, yeah.
People need to wake up. I tell my Democrat friends or teachers who love teaching, I tell them, do you want to become Chinese teachers that the federal government, central government tell you how to teach, what to teach, teach your test? You lose your autonomy. But don't vote for them, Democrats, anymore. You need to abolish Department of Education so you can have more control at local level.
That's right. Yes, absolutely. We had a lot of discussion about Obamacare. We still talk about Obamacare and the federal government taking over and micromanaging our health care. But there's really hasn't been any discussion, even though this has been around since the time before Ronald Reagan. It was put in by Jimmy Carter. It was less than 4 years old when Ronald Reagan took office. He said he was going to get rid of the Department of Education, but I believe it was eight times larger by the time he left 8 years later. So this is something that's been going on for quite a long time, and yet we've not seen any movement at all to stop it. Give us another idea about another priority that you would have in the Senate, and tell us a little bit about who you're running against in this race, the Democrats and Republicans.
I'm running against incumbent Michael Bennett. My senator, Michael Bennett, has been there for 7 years. He's a weak candidate. He voted 98% time with his party leadership and President Obama. He sold out his Democrat base who supported him on educational bills. And he also has a $7 million war chest for his reelection campaign from the bankers and lobbyists and special interests. So that, I think I have a real shot here because I have Republicans, conservatives, cross-party lines support me, endorse me, and our Republican candidates, five of them will be on the primary ballot, and a lot of them is really conservative or libertarian, so that I'm just going out as uniter, not divider. I tell my stories growing
okay,
up.
Okay, hang on there. Hang on, Lily. We're going to be right back with Lily Tang. You can find her at lily4liberty.com, and that's the number four. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Lily Tang Williams, the U.S. Senate candidate in Colorado. It's very important, you know, go to her website, lilyforliberty.com. Take a look at what she has to say. You know, you may not agree with everything that Lily has to say about every single issue, but it's very important that we get people of integrity, people who have a passion for liberty because they have been slaves in their past. She grew up in China. She grew up under Mao. As she said, I've been a slave before. I will never be one again. I hate to see the country that I love becoming more like the country that I left. Exactly. We need people who understand what this is about. We don't need to agree with any candidate, and you never will agree with any candidate 100%. I think you'll agree, if you like liberty, I think you'll agree with most of what Lily has to say. Before I go back to Lily, real quickly, we have a special, limited time special at InfoWars.com. If you sign up for the InfoWars newsletter, we will send you a promo code for 50% off Hillary for Prison t-shirt and the Come and Take It t-shirt. So we'll send that to you once you sign up for the Underground Insider newsletter. And of course, that's our free newsletter. And that newsletter frequently has promo codes and specials in it, as well as unique content that you don't see anywhere else. That newsletter is free. If you sign up for it, we'll give you a promo code for 50% off our two most popular t-shirts, Hillary for Prison and Come and Take It. Let's go back to Lily Tang Williams now. And Lily, I wanted to ask you about free trade, because sometimes we all agree as that we should have free trade, that we should be free in a marketplace to trade with each other. But the reality of the world that we live in is that sometimes the choices are not completely pure. What do you think about the transatlantic, trans-Pacific partnerships that are sold to us as free trade?
Well, I'm opposed to that. You know, free trade does not mean government-managed trade, does not mean secret deals with international corporations negotiate with each country's government. It does not mean to trump our constitutional right as American citizens. I am for free trade, and I am for actually just citizens and the business people trade with each other across international borders. All government has to do, you just have a couple pages, regulations to, you know, that's it. Why do we have 1,000 pages?
That's right.
And why do we involve lots of international globalists? Why do they negotiate behind doors? So I'm opposed to all managed government trade that give away our sovereignty of our country, our constitution. And my whole point of philosophy going to Washington is to cut size and the scope of government powers in Washington. So when they control the trade, when they negotiate deals like this, keep us out, and even sometimes do not, you know, really get approval from Congress, I have an issue with that.
I agree. And of course, I think the Trade Promotion Authority, the TPA that they passed, I think that was a betrayal of the Constitution, because it was both branches of Congress, the Senate and the House, essentially thumbing their nose at the process for ratifying a treaty. I totally agree with you. It is not free trade. It is managed trade. And Ron Paul has made that point as well. In the short amount of time that we've got left, I wanted to quickly ask you about civil asset forfeiture, the drug war, those types of things. If the government ignores the Constitution, how do we get them to pay attention to a law that would prohibit, let's say, civil asset forfeiture?
Well, the Congress has to do their job. I'm so disappointed that the congressional controlled by GOP, because you know, they got elected, say whatever get elected and promise a whole bunch of stuff they're gonna do, they never do it. They could not control even power first. That's why we have a constitution. We have a separation of powers. You need a principled people to go there to hold those you know, their oaths to uphold the constitution. You know, if they the branch.
I absolutely agree. I'm sorry. We're out of time, Lily. You're fired up for liberty. Absolutely. That's Liberty, lilyforliberty.com. And, of course, you can hear more from Lily Tang tonight on the InfoWars Nightly News at 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern with Leanne McAdoo. She's going to talk to her about her life under Mao. Join us then.